Welcome to Media Roots Radio. Today we have a very special in-person guest in the studio, journalist and author Yasha Levine. He's the former editor of Moscow-based satirical newspaper The Exile, the author of Surveillance Valley, The Secret Military History of the Internet, and also a journalist for Pando Daily. I first heard of Yasha Levine when he wrote an extremely controversial article called Almost Everyone Involved in Developing Tor Was or Is Funded by the U.S. Government. I remember when I first read this article, I found it pretty jarring myself, taken aback by a lot of the details that he included in the article. As Yasha Levine says, this information is out there, but it's not very well known, and it's certainly not emphasized by those who promote it. So today I'm extremely excited to be able to interview Yasha Levine, and this is going to be a very long interview, longer than what we normally do, but I thought it would be best to leave pretty much the entire discussion in its entirety. And mostly we spend time talking about his book, Surveillance Valley, and sort of the history of how the internet started as a military program and was turned into something for the public. I apologize for reading this verbatim, but it sums up his book better than I could. In Surveillance Valley, Yasha Levine traces the history of the internet back to its beginnings as a Vietnam-era tool for spying on guerrilla fighters and anti-war protesters, a military computer networking project that ultimately envisioned the creation of a global system of surveillance and prediction. Levine shows how the same military objectives that drove the development of early internet technology are still at the heart of Silicon Valley today. Spies, counterinsurgency campaigns, hippie entrepreneurs, privacy apps funded by the CIA. From the 1960s to the 2010s, this revelatory and sweeping story will make you reconsider what you know about the most powerful, ubiquitous tool ever created. Tell me about the Advanced Research Projects Agency, or ARPA. Why did they start it originally, and how did it evolve throughout the late 50s and 60s?
The Advanced Research Projects Agency, ARPA, is the defense sort of R&D wing of the Pentagon that we now know as DARPA. It started in 1957 as a response to the Sputnik. Sputnik was this small volleyball-sized satellite that the Soviet Union launched and went around the world a couple of times, you know, and let out this beep 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 and crashed into the atmosphere. But the Sputnik was significant at the time because what it showed, it wasn't the Sputnik that was the thing that freaked the military out and freaked America out, but it was the missile on which it went up. So it was the first intercontinental ballistic missile, ICBM. And what it showed at the time was that the Soviet Union had already developed, successfully tested a nuclear weapon, nuclear bomb. And so what it showed at the time was that the Soviet Union could potentially put a nuclear warhead on a missile and, you know, send it out and have it come down on any point in America. And at the time, the only defense that America had against nuclear attack was believed would be delivered by an airplane of some kind was an early warning radar system that wasn't even yet online, but they had been building it for 7 years at that point, 1957. It was this really massive project that spanned the entire nation. It was like the first really national computer network because it had all these radar installations. And it tied them up into these giant, like acre-sized IBM computer centers, and that could then, you know, those were connected to these terminals, and you could track enemy aircraft, and so you could track enemy aircraft and then potentially intercept them with fighter jets. And but like if it's a nuke, there's nothing that you could stop it—a nuke on a ICBM.
And this is before Russia actually developed their first nuclear weapon, right?
No, this is after.
Oh, this is after. Okay.
So this is after. So the first nuclear weapon I test was, I think, 1949.
Okay. Okay.
So it was like, but it was just, you know, exploded on the ground as a test in Kazakhstan.
Yeah.
But no, this is, so they already had they had nuclear capability, and now they developed, you know, the missile technology. It's sort of like what Korea has now.
Of course, yeah.
But I mean, there was a real successful, real, you know,
Did we have ICBM capable nukes at the time?
No.
No. Okay. Interesting. Okay.
Yeah. And so
wasn't aware of that.
And so that was part of like the freak out, right?
Okay.
That was the reason why the Sputnik was such a like a I mean it was really a like a cultural shock, I think, to America. I mean, on the one hand, it was because it was cool, you know, because there was this like thing up there circling Earth and sending out this radio signal that anyone could pick up with like a little, you know, radio. It showed that like, well, America was supposed to be this, you know, engine of growth and technology and technological innovation, you know, and like it actually failed in something as simple as fundamental as this, getting something into space for the first time. Right. So it got, the Soviet Union got something into space first.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was the start of the space race, right? That was the start of the space race. And so people culturally and, you know, culturally it was a shock because it showed that America was like inferior.
Mm-hmm.
And it made people really fear the Soviet Union suddenly because it's like, it was this, it looked like a, you know, technological powerhouse, right? Mm-hmm. That could outpace America. On the other hand, of course, there was the defense component there, right? Like, or, you know, President Eisenhower, like, essentially needed like a PR, needed to do something to put the public at ease and to put his critics at ease because he was, you know, painted as being going soft on communism and he was seen as weak because he allowed America to fall behind. And so ARPA was developed as kind of the solution to America's, you know, like technological backwardness.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it was
their gap.
The gap. Yes. Yeah. The good old gap. And so it was at the time it was seen as like a kind of an innovation because it was going to be a civilian agency that would be developing military missile technology, you know, mm-hmm. but it would be a civilian led agency. So it was going to be this kind of new type of management structure because it was seen that like that, you know, the normal military was like there was so much red tape and so much competition between the different armed services that like it actually stymied and held innovation back because it was like just this it was just a corrupt, you know, everybody wanted to increase their budget. There was overlapping, you know, projects that were developing the same kind of thing, but they weren't really getting anything done. So it was believed that you needed a kind of basically like a startup. So ARPA was this, you know, they didn't call it that back then, but it was seen as this lean, you know, government agency that would do like advanced weapons design focused primarily on space age stuff, like nuclear satellites and of course developing nuclear missile technology, right?
Mm. And this is done through a lot of private entities at the time.
So the idea was that it would function as almost like just a management kind of layer, but it would contract out all the work to private contractors, to military contractors. So
totally.
It'd be super lean. You know, you'd actually have almost nobody working there. I mean, it'd be a very small government agency that would pick the best, you know, candidate that could develop the technology, then farm it out, and then mm-hmm. reap the rewards of from that. That was the idea, and it was like ARPA was going to be this huge thing. It was a big deal, but ARPA very quickly was gutted because the armed services they saw that ARPA as a threat because it was a civilian led agency that was essentially going to take over a lot of the research, military research and weapons development that was being done by the Air Force, by the Army themselves, by the Navy themselves. And so they saw that ARPA as a threat to their power, to their funds, to their budget, you know. And so they conspired to get it defunded. And so, like 2 years after it was created, it was left with a tiny little budget. All of its programs got taken away from it. All of its missile development technology programs, and was handed over to a newly created agency called NASA. So NASA became this agency that took on a lot of the funds from ARPA, and NASA was a purely civilian agency. It didn't have any military application, so all the military stuff was still in the hands of the armed services and the non-military technology development. Although there was obviously overlap and kind of a synergy between these things, was like given to NASA, and ARPA was left dead on the road. And it was like expected that it would be, you know, eventually defunded completely, and it would just like die off. But then there was this guy named William Godel, who had come on pretty early. I think he came on a year or two after ARPA was created, as this kind of weird shadowy manager of various different projects that were kind of from ARPA. And he was pushing to make ARPA a kind of a counterinsurgency agency, the counterinsurgency technology agency that would develop tools and weapons for what he saw and what others saw at the time was a new kind of war that America was facing. So, like, you got to go back to that time, and in the 1960s, early 1960s, America was getting more involved in Vietnam, and of course that would lead to the Vietnam War. And it was facing insurgencies and guerrilla rebellions and all around the world at the time. And it was also facing an increasingly sort of hostile domestic situation, volatile domestic and political environment where, you know, you had the civil rights movement, you had militant black activism, you had the anti-war movement, you had powerful left-wing organizations like the Students for a Democratic Society. You had groups like the Weather Underground that are like detonating bombs in government buildings, seemingly on a daily basis. And so, you know, people looked at this in the military, looked at this, and they saw a kind of a new kind of war that was unfolding around the world, a war that you couldn't fight with nukes. You couldn't really drop a nuke on, you know, Detroit, unless, I mean, maybe, you know, some people probably wouldn't mind that, but you couldn't drop you couldn't send a tank division in there because, well, the enemy wasn't wearing uniform. Mm-hmm. It wasn't like walking in formation. The enemy in these guerrilla movements, whether they were abroad or domestic, and domestically they thought that it wasn't a real insurgency that was basically being underwritten by the Soviet Union at the time.
Of course, yeah.
They were part of the civilian population. And so the idea was, how do you fight these new wars? You needed new kinds of weapons to fight this new kind of insurgency. And so William Godel, who had like a long history working in the Navy, but also being this kind of liaison between the Navy, the CIA, and the NSA, and he worked for ARPA. He was kind of in this strange shadowy guy who was pushing Eisenhower to make ARPA like the seat of the development of this new kind of technology. And it wasn't like just. So there was different kind of stuff. So there is, how do you fight insurgencies, right? We need like a think tank and an R&D lab to figure that out. And so he was pushing for ARPA to be that. Mm-hmm. And it didn't go anywhere for a couple of years, but when John F. Kennedy was elected, he really liked the idea, and he gave William Godel the green light to remake ARPA into a counterinsurgency research and development agency, and that's what happened. And that's sort of the beginning of the setup of where the internet was about to come from.
You go into William Godel quite a bit in your book, and there's just a lot of personalities in your book in general that I for the most part haven't even heard of, and how crucial some of these people were to the development of what we know today is the internet. Early on in your book, you can actually pull a couple quotes from two different U.S. officials about what kind of signals intelligence was already available to them during the Vietnam War, that was based around some of this technology being developed at the time. And one of the quotes was, "There's this main control room that looks like the one we saw on TV during the Apollo moonshots, or maybe something out of a James Bond movie. There's computer terminals everywhere, but the main feature is a huge three-story tall lucite, or maybe it's plastic, I don't know, full-color depiction of the whole Ho Chi Minh Trail with real-time depictions of trucks coming down the trail. It's wild, man." And then some guy named John T. Halliday, a retired Air Force pilot, says that, "Remember those huge electronic boards from the movie Dr. Strangelove that showed Russian bombers headed for the U.S. and ours headed at them?" he wrote. "Well, Task Force Alpha is a lot like that, except with real-time displays in full color, three stories tall. It's the whole goddamn Ho Chi Minh Trail in full living color." so speak on that a little bit. So this was What time period was this exactly? The mid-60s?
Yeah.
Okay.
So this, and what he's referring to, so this guy, this is pulled out of a memoir that was written by an Air Force pilot who was running bombing raids during the Vietnam War on the Ho Chi Minh Trail. And so what happened, so ARPA was involved in a lot of different projects during the Vietnam War. And it was involved in everything from figuring out, like, sort of, you know, strategy to de-incentivize rebellion, you know. And they were testing out in the field things like, does hunger work, you know, does starvation work to, you know, de-incentivize rebellion in unrest of, like, populations in Southeast Asia? Does it do targeted assassinations work? Do, like, relocation into sort of secure village compounds, does that help to isolate the population from the sort of insurgent population that is among it? And does that make it easier to isolate and to sort of bring out and out of hiding the insurgents, you know, like things like that. So very human, like very direct, you know, hands-on kind of population control as a way to fight insurgencies. At the same time, they were developing high-tech stuff, like developing the first drones, you know, creating these drones that, which were essentially miniaturized helicopters. Could be controlled by radio, and the radio, like control apparatus, was like, you know, mounted on this Jeep, on this Jeep Wrangler, you know, old school, like Jeep, original Jeep, and you know, it's pretty funny. The controller, you know, the drone controller is just a Jeep loaded with all these, you know, all this radio gear. It's pretty funny, and then you have to have line of sight with a drone, so you couldn't get too far away.
Yeah,
and so I mean, that's the original, the first ones, you know.
Yeah,
those drones are actually also used. By the Navy, because you could fly them, fly them out and like look for, like basically like look for torpedoes and like look for, you know, submarines. And so the idea was almost like a scout ship, right?
Yeah.
You could, and you have aerial view. So, but ARPA was involved in that. You know, ARPA was also involved in developing the M16, what now is like used in all these school shootings as a lighter, smaller, sort of machine gun that could be used in the field, and that could be used by, you know, Vietnamese South Vietnamese soldiers, because they were seen as kind of smaller than, you know, the average American, and you know they had to carry them in the jungle, and so you needed a new kind of smaller machine gun that could pack the same kind of firepower. So they were doing all that stuff as well. And one of the projects that ARPA worked on was was what they called trying to bug the battlefield.
Mm-hmm.
So air cover or jungle cover was a really big problem for American military doctrine at the time, because at the time the way that the Vietnam War was being fought is basically you just try to bomb everything, annihilate everything, just carpet bomb everything. If something moves, you call in an airstrike and just take everything out that's there. But the problem was that there was a jungle. You know, the jungle was a problem because you can't see what's on the ground. And so the Ho Chi Minh Trail was allowed North Vietnamese fighters to move, you know, giant convoys of weapons and people across the border into South Vietnam from Laos, and like move completely undetected stage these surprise raids on American and South Vietnamese forces. And so one of the things that ARPA did was led the testing of Agent Orange to what it would do is destroy the jungle cover, basically was destroy all plant life, and so denude, you know, the jungle completely, and so that was one of the ways of dealing with jungle cover, is to just destroy everything, and ARPA played a central role in testing Agent Orange. It's really horrific and very very brutal and, heartless way of waging war, because it still affects people today. People are born with deformities because of the toxicity of that chemical.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, doesn't go away, just stays in the ground and gets in the water supply. So that was, and, but it also helped develop this, again, this high tech, network, surveillance network, where they would be able to drop sensors into the jungle from the air, and these things would, like, there's like little missiles that would point down, and they'd wedge into the ground like a stake, and they'd have like microphones, they would have like urine detectors, they would have vibration detectors, And the idea is that you spread this around the general area of the trail, and you could be able to hear, like, if there's, you know, cars moving, they vibrate the ground. If they're like, you know, trucks, if you can detect urine in the environment around the sensor, that means that there's like people moving through their peeing. Of course, then there's microphones. You could hear people talk, or you could hear a car move, or whatever. And so that was like, these were wireless sensors that were developed in partnership with ARPA, and they would then relay this information via a series of repeaters, you know, that would then direct the signal to a command center that ran on an IBM computer, and they had like a visual representation of the Ho Chi Minh Trail, and things would like light up, you know, like a sector would light up. It'd be like, oh, there's vibration here, or there's urine detection here.
Yeah, yeah.
And then, or there's like, oh, there's a, like some sound coming in, and they like be able to hear. It's like, oh, there's some Vietnamese, you know, like being spoken. And then they say, okay, we're getting movement, you know, in sector C9, and they call in an airstrike. And so the idea was to create this sort of digital cybernetic battlefield where you didn't even need to have anyone there to know what's going on, mm-hmm. right? You'd be able to do it with this network of sensors. So ARPA was very much involved in that. But what was interesting about that is that, first of all, that technology would very quickly be imported back to America and would then be used in the Mexican-American border to create the sort of digital, you know, fence that you'd be able to tell, you know, if someone's crossing the border based on, again, vibrations and things like that. So that technology was used very quickly domestically. Mm-hmm. It was tested in Vietnam and used domestically. And in Vietnam, it proved to be a total failure. I mean, it worked in theory.
Yeah.
But the problem is that the Vietnamese were able to game it because they understood what was going on. And they knew that you could like just like piss on a sensor. Mm-hmm. And it would think that there's someone there. And then, you'd like jump up and down, or like, you know, next to one of those vibration sensors, and they'd think that there'd be a huge convoy, you know, coming through, and they'd call in an airstrike, but there'd be just empty jungle. Meanwhile, they're moving the convoy through another position, mm-hmm. you know. So that cybernetic system, and it gave military planners this feeling of superiority and power, because the model that they saw was that there were troop movements and they were being annihilated. Mm-hmm. You know, there was an objective, you know, and it was being hit. And they were winning because they were killed, you know, they were destroying all this stuff, but they didn't ever, you know, go and check, because, I mean, it was hostile territory, you know, it's like pretty difficult to go out there. But so the system gave them a sense of empowerment, mm-hmm. But it was actually being used against them and used to deceive them. So it was a kind of an interesting lesson in how the models that you create about the world and then act on don't necessarily guarantee success, even if you have superiority, it seems like, or knowledge superiority. It's kind of like with Hillary Clinton, maybe, you know. and her like super duper, you know, a data system that like modeled everything, you know, and predicted everything, and they drove all parts of her campaign. I mean, and those two things are actually much more connected than they actually are directly connected, because the technology that was developed there in Vietnam, you know, with input from ARPA. You can draw a straight line from that cybernetic system that bugged the battlefield to, you know, data systems that are powering elections today. You know, I mean, they are on a continuum. I mean, it's the logical end result of that, and they actually are very much connected. So,
of course, I mean, even just the idea of if we waged I guess Iraq wouldn't necessarily be the best example, because I don't know how many people there actually used cell phones, but if we wage some kind of modern war today on the battlefield, I mean, it would be, you know, unless every insurgent turned off their cell phone or every electronic tracking device, you know, that would be one way to populate a virtual battlefield or some kind of screen or whatever. I mean, but it's so much more sophisticated today that technology almost seems kind of novelty.
Yeah, you don't need to put sensors on the ground anymore. The sensors are built into, you know, how we live. So we have our cell phones, we have our computers, we have our cars with our GPS systems, you know, and our like OnStar systems that, mm-hmm. you know, are always dialing back. You have your Tesla that's basically connected to the internet, you know, like so we have actually our entire, we wear the sensors on us. Mm-hmm. And the same thing is true for, you know, for like the war in Afghanistan or Iraq, or you know, when your drone strikes are called in very frequently based on, you know, cell phone signals. And so those are very important in actually targeting combatants, you know. And again, that phone signal could be, I mean, they're not stupid, you know, just like the Vietnamese were not stupid about it. So it's like you can use that to deceive or to give yourself cover if you understand how it's being used against you. And so this idea of bugging the battlefield, again, this is something that's now half a century you know, old, this idea, you know, is we live in a reality that it's actually true. You know, the battlefield has been bugged, and the battlefield is kind of not just a military battlefield, but it's like all society. Mm-hmm. Society is like that. We're all bugged. We're all walking around. We all can be modeled and watched. So yeah. So it's and if you look at any presentations about modern command control communication systems, you know, and about like, I mean, this is just like a normal part of what the military does. You know, you're always building models of troop movements, of your own troop movements, of supply needs, of your enemy's movements, of what their capabilities are. You know, and you're using that based on information you're getting from satellites, from, you know, cell phones, from you know, intercepted communications, and so that integrated kind of battlefield, the cybernetic battlefield, is like, it is much more sophisticated today than it was 50 years ago when it was just being built. But it's probably no more effective in helping actually America win wars.
Yeah, it doesn't. I mean, it seems like it sets you up for having just overconfidence about what's going on and a false perception of reality. But we can get into this later. But yeah. I'm very curious to hear your thoughts on this idea that how do you protect yourself against this kind of stuff? And it seems like the most popular sort of activist method currently is encryption.
Yeah.
And I know you have a lot of opinions on that, so maybe we can talk about those later. But,
well, I mean, you know, encryption, I mean, I don't know. It's encryption is one of these things. Encryption is a domain for militaries and for governments. You know, I mean, look, in the same way that, okay, light encryption does help protect your information from people who might want to steal it, you know, from hackers, who identity thieves and things like that. Like, just the same way that a door lock protects your home from invasion, you know, and from robbery, you know, to a degree.
Yeah.
Because if someone really wants to get in, no lock will stop it.
Yeah.
You know? They'll break the window. They'll break down the door. They'll get in through the skylight. I mean, there's so many different ways of, or like, you know, like, or like Santa Claus, they'll go through the chimney. You know, there's like all these different ways that you can get in, but it does serve as some protection, you know? But I think as a protection from, I mean, the question is, who are you protecting yourself from? So your door is not going to protect you from the NSA. Mm-hmm. Your door is not going to protect you from the FBI. Your door is not going to protect you from even your local police necessarily, depending on who you are, you know? And the door is also not going to protect you from people who are really motivated to get in. And it's the same thing with encryption, I think. You know, it doesn't matter what encryption you're using, you know, it really won't protect you from people who are motivated to get in, because there's all sorts of different ways to get in. Mm-hmm. But the question is, who are you afraid of and why? Mm-hmm. You know, I think this is a central question that people should ask themselves when they start thinking about, like, I need to use encryption, I need to use Signal, I need to use Tor. The question is, who are you protecting yourself? I mean, what are you actually doing? Mm-hmm. I mean, are you, if you're trying to overthrow the state, you know, good luck to you, man, you know, good luck with Tor, you know, good luck with Signal. I mean, aside from the fact that they're funded by the US government, that aside, you know, it's like, it doesn't matter what you use, you know, it's like, if you're, you know, anything lower than that, like, what is the protection from? Who is the protection from? It's very like people's idea of privacy seems very, it's not definite, you know. You can't really explain what you're afraid of, mm-hmm. right? Just you're afraid of generally being surveilled, which is a strange fear, because we're surveilled all the time. You know, we go out on the street, we're watched by people.
Yeah.
you know, and of course, when people talk about that, they never really think about being surveilled by Google or being surveilled by Facebook or being surveilled by your telephone company, because no amount of, you know, Tor or signal is going to prevent that, because we use these services every day. Mm-hmm. And the normal encryption technology that's available to us doesn't protect us from corporate surveillance, which is, you know, and then of course that whatever Google has and whatever Facebook has, the NSA has, the FBI has, the CIA has, you know, like, I mean, I don't know. This is a big topic. I mean, maybe we can get into it.
Let's save it for the end. Yeah.
Yeah.
Cause I know I have a lot more questions about it. Yeah. And you have a lot more to say about it.
I mean, if you're like, you know, it's, I mean, if you're ISIS, you know, you probably don't want to be like running around the desert with a cell phone signal, you know, like, you probably want to put it in airplane mode.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I don't know. That's my suggestion. Not that I'm, you know, in any way affiliated with that terrorist organization.
We are not advocating for giving ISIS fighters ideas, but you could technically do that, and it would probably save you, you know, a drone strike or two.
Airplane mode. It's literally airplane mode, isn't it?
Yeah.
the drone mode.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you say in your book what Karl Marx's Das Kapital did for 19th century socialists, Norbert Wiener's cybernetics did for America's anti-communist cold warriors. Explain what cybernetics is and why you think it was so influential.
Well, you know, I mean, cybernetics is influential because we live in a cybernetic world. And so the ideas that underpin our computer world, our internet world, you know, originated largely from the mind of this one guy named Norbert Wiener. And Norbert was this brilliant, brilliant guy. Like, he was a, you know, savant. He went to, I think, Harvard at age 13. You know, his dad made him, like, memorize, you know, like, entire Greek tragedies and recite them from memory when he was, like, in his, you know, he was, like, 9 or 10. Mm-hmm. And he was this really brilliant mathematician who would end up teaching at MIT. And his contribution to the world is kind of coming up with this idea of realizing that information is something almost like a physical resource or something physical, because, you know, information isn't just like abstract or doesn't just exist in the mind, but actually can cause a reaction in the real world. And like, you imagine, like, you know, a cat chasing a mouse, you know, the fact that the mouse sees the cat running after it makes it like run away. Mm-hmm. And so, it's the mouse is receiving information through its sense organs and it's processing it through its brain and all these things. But like the fact that, you know, that it's getting information about the cat and that the cat wants to eat it and it runs away, you know, so the information is transfers actually has a, like, a physical effect. Mm-hmm. And his other leap is to understand that, like, you could have information transfer between, you know, humans, people, and machines, and that machines could also be designed in such a way as to be part of a kind of an information transfer with people. So you could actually create a sort of a binding between people and machines. And then he developed this into a kind of multidisciplinary science or study of what he called cybernetics, and he described it as the study of information in humans and machines, and where he saw that the world, like, sort of writ large, is kind of an information machine, like that everything is sort of exists in, you know, in reality. But everything interacts with everything else in this kind of interlocking network of information, and that information is courses through nature, you know, and has impact on nature. So it has there are these relationships, informational relationships. I mean, that exist, and you could make machines be sort of a part of that. You know, you can build machines or computers, like robots or whatever, that respond or like part of this chain of information that the world is made up of. And so, you know, and he came out of a very specific kind of experience that he had during the war, which was that he was recruited during World War II to create a firing mechanism that could predict the movement of an aircraft. So it's a ground air, like basically cannon, right, that could shoot down enemy aircraft. There was a really big problem because Nazi Germany was doing these like bombing raids over England. And it was, you know, it was very hard to shoot them down because, you know, because if you fire something from a cannon, it takes a certain amount of time to fly to a destination. And so by that time, because these fighter jets were so fast, you didn't know where they were going to be in 30 seconds into the future or a minute into the future, right? And so he was put on this task, a secret project that could figure out a way, if you can use machines and this early computer technology to predict where that aircraft will be in the future. And so his work on cybernetics came out of that. So he came up with this idea where, you know, you have a machine that's controlled by a person who's aiming it and pointing it at something. And then through various signals that it's getting from the aircraft about its movement and things like that, it essentially, you know, swivels the turret, you know, in anticipation of where it'll be, and then that's where the human operator fires. And so you have this sort of machine that's coupled with a person, you know, mm-hmm. in this way of, and they, and together they are much more powerful, right, than they would be alone. And so this machine makes a person basically predict the future, you know, on some level, and it's a very specific kind of way. It makes them like God, you know, on some very minor, it's very small scale. You could see a minute into the future where that airplane will be. And so it made him think about creating these sort of systems where you have a machine and a human being coupled together. And that's what cybernetics was. It's a study of these systems. And, you know, why he wrote the book in, I believe it was 1948. Cybernetics came out and it was a huge hit. It was a bestseller. Despite it was being like all full of mathematical formulas and things like that, because it was a huge hit in military circles, because it showed that you could create machines that would almost, you could almost start to write people, you know, out of warfare. You could create the machines that could be much more efficient than people, you know, you could replace people. They wouldn't get tired. You could have intelligence systems where you could have actually machines potentially thinking about or understanding language and then transcribing intercepts, decoding them, automatically without the need to have people sit there and label over these things. That you could create intelligent machines that could take human capability and sort of extend it and expand it. Create cyborgs, you know, and on this very, you know, like in this very kind of, you know, in this very kind of steampunk way, right? It wasn't like, you know, it's not a cyborg that you see yeah. on like Deep Space Nine or something, but like it's not the Borg, but it's more of a, you know, like a mechanical contraption that a person is sitting next to, totally. An electromechanical contraption, because this is the late 40s and early 50s, and so he inspired this whole way of looking at the world and looking at computers and looking at human beings, actually, because if you think of the whole world as an information network and an information machine, then we are just information networks or information machines, and then computers are also information machines. So actually, we're a kind of advanced computer, right? And so, if we're an advanced computer and we have these very rudimentary computers that we're just beginning to tinker with, then we can actually build much more complex computers that begin to mimic people and begin to take over some of the functions that people normally took, and can do it much faster, because you can run calculations much faster. Computers don't get tired. Computers can be deployed in all sorts of environments that people can't exist in, and all these things. So like it really fired the imagination of the military industrial complex, because they could see that weapons could be automated. Mm-hmm. And um, and and their power could be vastly expanded. And America, if it stayed ahead in this sort of cybernetics arms race, if it was the one that dominated, then no other military would be able to challenge it. You know, then the Soviet Union, already the Cold War was beginning to heat up. The Soviet Union couldn't challenge American power. And so, you know, cybernetics and Norbert Wiener were these really instrumental things to the internet that we use today, or just most technology, actually, computer technology. But what was interesting about him is that he immediately turned against his own creation, because he was this, because he's understood that, you know, these computer systems, these information systems, they would give power to the people who controlled them.
Yeah.
And so he didn't see them as like, you know, he saw that they had a liberatory potential. They could be, in theory, used for the general betterment and for the benefit of mankind on some kind of bigger level. But he understood that unless the political system and politics were reformed or actually radically altered, unless, you know, America wasn't just in pursuit of profit and global domination, then these systems would be put to that use. So if the culture, the political culture, was about money and amassing power, then these systems would be put to that use. And so, like, just a few years after writing the seminal work, Cybernetics, he wrote another book, very cool book. I even recommend that people read it, because it's actually surprisingly modern. It's called The Human Use of Human Beings. And he and that's how he kind of saw these new cybernetic systems. He saw that human beings would deploy these information systems and these computer systems to use human beings and even more effectively to exploit people. And he saw how his cybernetic ideas were not just favored by the military and were already being, you know, put to use to develop, you know, artificial intelligence, as they call them now. Back then, it was called cybernetics.
Yeah.
But also auto manufacturers wanted to deploy these ideas to automate factories, to automate assembly lines. And he saw, like, you know, this is early 50s, and he saw that that if this would keep going the way that it was already at the time, that it would create mass unemployment unemployment on a mass level, that it would create people who are completely unnecessary to society, mm-hmm. who have no role in it, who are not part of the productive process of society. Everything would be automated, so, you know, manual labor would be automated. People who worked in factories would just be thrown away. And he warned that this will bring about a catastrophe that we have, like, of a kind that we have not yet seen before in modern societies, because it's going to create mass unemployment and mass poverty. And I mean, we are seeing what he predicted back then, and he turned against it, and he even tried to work with labor unions at the time to warn them, to say, like, look, this is what's coming down the pipeline. There's going to be this automation, and, you know, automation in not like the sense of, you know, full communism automation, where everybody reaps the benefits of that and we all live fuller lives without having to work, you know, all the time. But it would be automation in the service of, you know, concentrated capital, and basically workers are going to get screwed, and they're going to get screwed pretty quickly, pretty soon. So you better, like, know what's coming. And so he was put on the FBI subversive list, and he was being J. Edgar Hoover, tracked him, and he was like, he was considered a subversive, and he refused to do any kind of military contracting mm-hmm. after that. And so he was really became a pariah, and he sat at MIT, which is like the center of, you know, military industrial research. It's basically like a military university.
Yeah, yeah.
And he sat there. He was one of the most influential, one of the best known, one of the most brilliant people there. And he, like, refused to have anything to do with military research after that. And became this old kind of crank and lost his eyesight and, you know, slowly kind of faded and died. But, you know, the guy that created this, or like, created the intellectual framework for the creation of these computer systems, was also the guy who was the first to warn about them.
Yeah.
And saw where it was headed. And it was interesting. He said, like, look, a computer labor or automated labor is like slave labor because it has no rights. It can be worked forever.
Yeah.
To the ground, you know, until the motherboard, you know, burns up. Like a person cannot compete with slave labor, you know?
Yeah.
And so normal workers cannot compete with that. So the slave labor, the computer slave labor is going to win and it's going to take over everything. And unless we radically change society, we're all screwed. And here we are, you know, with mass unemployment and mass poverty, and in large part because of automation, but not just automation on its own, but because of the political culture that surrounds automation that doesn't spread out the benefits of automation equally, right?
Yeah.
And the benefits of increased efficiency in our productive workplace and stuff.
It's funny that that used to be the way that they would refer to it as cybernetics, which implies that humans play a role, a significant role, you know, in sort of enhancing human abilities or things like that. But I feel like the way we talk about things now, it's all about AI, which in a way would eliminate the need for a human, you know, human consciousness. So it's interesting how actually worse it's gotten since then, where now it doesn't even seem like there's not very many people talking about, you know, unless we're talking about like military mech suits.
No, but you're right.
You don't see much in that area anymore.
You're totally right. I mean, it's like
even for like drone piloting is now they're already starting to move over to like fully automated or algorithmically driven systems and stuff like that.
That makes sense. I mean, because you're writing the person out. I mean, that's what he was sort of talking about.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So before it was about because you needed the human operator to some degree, you know. But again, the more advanced these systems get, the more complex the programming, and you know, the more complex is the quote unquote intelligence, because these systems are not intelligent, and I don't think they ever will be, and because they're not, you know, they don't have their own, they're only a function as they can seem complex and intelligent, but they can only function with the parameters of the programming, you know. But yeah, you write out people completely, and it's a strange system, right? It's a strange society that like tries to write out its own people out of its own. it's again, there's no place for people anymore, because unless you're part of this machine that makes things, or unless you can be used in some way and exploited, like you're not really necessary, right? Yeah, it's very weird. It's we've gone completely to the other side now.
In a way, it makes some of these like dystopian, and I won't stay on this topic for too long, but it just made me think about like some of these dystopian sci-fi stories, you know, about humans, you know, like one that comes to mind is The Matrix, using as a human battery. But I mean, maybe at some point it's like, if they come up with some kind of computer brain interface, and they'll be like, well, would you be willing to use your body as part of our computer farm?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that I'm not saying that like that's when AI is going to really take over, but it seems like that might be our role at some point, where just people who can't, you know, might not be able to contribute to this system might be like, well, you know, my brain's a computer and it can be used for the cloud or whatever.
Maybe. Yeah. Maybe. I mean, it's, I don't know.
It's a horrible thought.
I take a kind of a, My position on the whole brain computer thing is I don't think we're computers, you know. I mean we're clearly there's some information processing, right? But a computer is, you know, like we are things that evolved over like millennia, like evolved out of just like this protoplasm, you know, like we are very much embodied, like we're not general purpose computers, you know. We're made very specifically to do certain things, to live in a certain environment. Of course, we're very adaptable, and that's part of why we're sort of so successful as a species, you know, and so successfully destructive. We're very adaptable to a lot of different environments, much more so than any other, I think, living organism, at least like multicellular on Earth, you know. But I mean, like we're not a general purpose computer, you know. We're not like, I think that, you know. If they ever like replicate a human intelligence, they'll actually just build a human being. You know, that's what it'll become. Like, look, we synthetically created a computer that's totally human. You know, it's like you look at it, it's a human being.
Yeah,
like that was actually 3D printed in like in exactly the same configuration and has exactly the kind of same cellular structure that a human being does. And it's like, ah, Okay. Like in the same way that, you know, you can sort of model a, you know, a hurricane on a computer, right? And you can really model it and, you know, you can create like, okay, this is how it's going to act. And you can model all the different little forces inside the, you know, the what would make a hurricane, all the environmental factors that go into it. But to actually create a hurricane, you actually have to create a hurricane. You know, like it actually has to be a hurricane in the world.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Like, so it's like you can make a human being that acts, that seems to be a human being. But like, what does that mean? You know, right? Like, so they can fool you. You can, you know, you can be fooled that they're human. They seem very human. But like, again, it gets into the outer limits of philosophy and philosophy of mind that basically has been stuck in the same place for, you know, like almost 100 years or 60 years. Like, what is a mind? You know, what is it? What is consciousness? What does it mean? Like, is it real? Is it not real? Are we just delusional about our own consciousness? You know, or... Rock have consciousness? Yeah. Does your iPhone have consciousness? You know, like, I don't know, but I do think that something, you know, what makes us is just us, you know?
Yeah.
Like, actually the down to the way that we're made, on a cellular level and the way that we've evolved into our present state. So yeah, it's weird. I mean, like, you imagine like a dog, like a computer dog, you know, like, you could probably fake one, you know, yeah, at some point.
Yeah.
But that's like, is it, does it think start, like a yeah. dog? Like, yeah. Does it have dog consciousness? I don't know. You know,
we'll see. I guess we'll find out soon.
Yeah. Just getting into some.
Yeah. I mean, that's the problem with talking about Silicon Valley is now even people like Elon Musk are talking about the holographic universe theory and stuff like that. So, you know, I mean,
there's quantum
computers, you know, that are being developed by Google and, you know, yeah. I don't know how much of that stuff is just like PR, you know, sci-fi kind of like, look how futuristic we are, you know, how serious it is. But
I take a very skeptical view of it. You know, they've been trying to invent AI from the very beginning. I mean, that's what cybernetics is. It's intelligent machines.
Mm-hmm.
And, just for some reason, cybernetics, like the term, fell out of favor and it became artificial intelligence. You know, that's what, like, that's the acceptable way of calling cybernetics. But I don't know. I mean, you know, it's like, okay, quantum computer. Okay, so you have a computer that has more than one state. It's not just like one and zero, but it has like, you know, a lot of different states. So you can process. You can actually process things very, very quickly. So it just speeds up processing power.
Yeah.
Okay, great.
You know, yeah,
like,
yeah.
You can get like a core of, you know, like you can run like a multi-core computer with, you know, 1,000 cores. You know, I don't know. I mean, it's not a quantum computer, but it has.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
It's just like, so you can crack encryption faster. You can solve problems faster. But like, the question is, what are your fucking problems? You know, like Google has all this power. It has a global network computer. So all of its computers are actually networked together,
mm-hmm.
you know, in its data centers and like small computers, but they're all networked together so they can operate in unison, right? Like a multi processor network computer. And what is it doing, right? Like, what is its function? It's like runs to show us ads, to show us targeted ads. You know, how pathetic is that? I mean, all the other stuff that it does, you know, tracking us and, you know, but that's still plugged into the function of showing us advertisement, you know?
Exactly.
It was the most banal, most depressing thing in the world, you know? Like, you have this giant corporation, you know, just unlimited resources. It's tied to the national security state. It's, you know, it runs these massive server farms, you know, these supercomputers, can do all this cool shit, right? And at its core, it's just an ad agency, you know?
Yeah.
It's really depressing.
Yeah.
So like, what are you going to use the quantum computer for? To show us even more ads, you know?
Yeah.
Like, really target them really well, you know?
Yeah. To be like, able to scan our emails faster.
Yeah, like so, like, you know, it'll do it, you know, a fraction of a second after you send it, you know, rather than like
yeah.
2 seconds afterwards. It's, I mean, it's
it is really depressing.
That's what I mean about all this, like, yeah, and it is PR, I think, you know, because it's always about keeping us enthralled to the next, like, next invention, to the next breakthrough, and so that we think the technology is really moving forward and it's going to open up all these possibilities.
Yeah.
But look at the possibilities that we have now.
Mm-hmm.
There's enough power, computing power, to do, you know, I don't know what, but there's more than enough computing power. I mean, look, we're like surrounded by computers in this room, right? In your room here, but where you go out, you're surrounded by computers. Just they're everywhere. And like, what is it? What do they do? They do nothing very interesting, right?
Yeah.
I mean, and all the other cool stuff that they do had already kind of been, existed. You know, movies and, they just get more and more complex. But like the format is still hasn't really been, and things haven't really changed. There's nothing new in the world, really, And so I don't know. I'm very down on, skeptical of these promises of innovation and promises of
course.
the next leap in technological, power and whatever. Yeah.
You know, one of the companies that gets sort of tarred the most from this era of early computing is IBM.
Mm.
And, of course, a lot of people relate it back to the Holocaust, how its systems were used to database people in concentration camps. But you brought up some other interesting examples that could also be interpreted as nefarious for using their databasing technology around the same time, even after. But talk about some other examples of this and just the larger idea of sort of when, not just IBM, but like how these databases started to be used for mm-hmm. political purposes.
Yeah. I mean, look, so one of the realizations that I came to when writing this book, because I never even thought I'd go in this direction, really. So the thesis that that came out of all my research is that computer technology, on a very basic level, is about surveillance, and it's about management. So it's about surveilling the world and then giving whoever is going to use that data kind of a better handle on what to do in the world. So getting information about the world and people and business processes, and then so you can take action on that intelligence. And so IBM is a perfect example of that. The dark side of that is in the Holocaust, and was used by Nazi Germany to more efficiently run its slave labor system and to sort of manage its labor pool, among other things, but also to better isolate people with who are Jews from various records that you could isolate people with who are a quarter Jewish, who might not even be Jewish, who might not even realize that they're Jewish. But like, if you go back in time and look at when IBM technology was developed, the punch card technology. It developed in the late 19th century in America by an American named Herman Hollerith.
And were you saying he was inspired by sort of what had already existed for a while, which is like train ticket punchers?
Yeah. So he was in essence contracted by the U.S. Census to mm-hmm. come up with a better way of counting the census, to enumerating the census, because you got to do the census every 10 years. It's in the Constitution. You got to carry it out every 10 years. And at that point, it took so long to do the census that it was already time to do the next census by the time that they hadn't even finished counting the last one.
Wow. Because
they were doing it by hand. And so he came up with this way of encoding the census information better so that it can be counted automatically. And he came up with this punch card. Yeah, and you're right, exactly. Like, his idea was that a punch card was like a portrait of a person. So, and a punch card has little fields, and little markings, and you punch each of those little boxes based on their attributes, based on their age, based on their sex, based on, let's say how much they make, what their ethnicity is, things like that. So you can actually punch out a paper portrait, but it's like a paper digital portrait of a person. And then that punch card then stands for that person. And then that punch card can go into the stack. And then he invented a contraption that you can, feed these punch cards into, and then they can be counted very quickly, obviously, because it's just it's a mechanical, ticker. But also you can sort those punch cards based on attributes. So if you want to find, people who are, have like overlapping attributes, like who are, felons, who, were born in New York, and who are orphans, you could like run all of your census data through that, and basically isolate the people who match that criteria. And so mm-hmm. he developed that technology, and it was first put to use in 1890 to count the 1890 U.S. Census, and it was the first kind of computer, because it allowed you to digitize data into these punch cards, and then to manipulate that data in pretty sophisticated ways at the time that was unfathomable. Mm-hmm. And one of the reasons why it was one of the reasons why the U.S. Census was getting so long is because at the time there was a huge freak out over immigration into America from Southern Europe and from Eastern Europe. So the sort of the Anglo-Saxon elite of America were extremely worried that the pure sort of genetic superiority of Americans that was hard won by them coming to this new world and struggling for survival, you know, and through a Darwinian process, you know, they came to embody the best genes in the world, you know. So even there was like a pyramid at the time, and Americans stood at the top of the genetic pyramid. Anglo-Saxons, like sort of, you know, their ancestors, you know, from Britain, were below one level, and then there were the Germans, and then it went down from there, you know. You know, America was supposed to have the most pure genetic stock out of all nations in the world. And here there was this sort of influx, huge flow of immigration coming from these sub-racial groups, you know, like Italians and Eastern Europeans. And like, there was a lot of fear at the time that, I don't know, they were gonna mess things up. And so there was the birth of eugenics and the kind of a eugenicist movement where the racial purity of America became extremely important suddenly. And it was the emergence of this new racial science. And the racial science required data about the people, about the population. And so the census at the time became an instrument to collect more and more sort of racial data about the American population, about the people who were coming into America. And so that's why the census got so big that it took so long to count. So before it was pretty simple and it could be counted pretty quickly, but there was more and more data about the racial makeup of Americans in the census. And so the IBM punch card was essentially invented to count that data. So mm-hmm. The punch card was very much intertwined with racial science and
yeah.
racial profiling and eugenics
mm-hmm.
and this obsession with racial purity. And of course, that was one of the forces that drove it, but of course it became much more it was a multi-use technology. It could be used by railroads really got into it because they could organize their schedules and sort of timetables much better, and they could use it to track shipping. And so large businesses and corporations were really into IBM technology from the very beginning, because it could allowed them to manage their business processes much faster. The army, the U.S. Army, was very much into it as well, because it could manage their, keep track of their manpower, like, you know, the number of people it had, who's on sick leave, you know, what kind of diseases they had, so you could manage manage the military much more effectively. IBM was then, of course, used by FDR when created the Social Security program. It was basically run by IBM. It couldn't have been done by anyone else. So IBM powered, you know, welfare, mm-hmm. and it ran on IBM. It was like that was the computational power. So on the one hand, you could use it for eugenics and to do this creepy kind of racial science and try to figure out, like, you know, if America is being infected by bad genes. But at the same time, you could use it for good and to run, you know, to give people. Keep them alive and happy in their old age through a welfare system. And so, you know, IBM has this sort of dual thing where it shows that it can, you know, computer technology can be used for good or bad, right? It's not like, it's somewhat, it depends on the culture and the society that uses the technology. And it could also be used to run slave labor camps by Nazi Germany. And so all these things are happening at the same time, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you had an interesting quote in your book from somebody from, I think it was a Nazi official, proclaiming like their excitement at the opening of the IBM factory.
Yeah.
They were aware of at the time of how valuable that could be, or what they were planning on doing.
It's really creepy. I mean, the whole like Nazi IBM connection is really an interesting one. And the story, I mean, I recommend people read What's the book?
IBM and the Holocaust.
Yes, IBM and the Holocaust. Yeah. Thanks.
I have it.
Yeah, it's a great book. It's a bit like it's pretty dark. I mean, so when IBM subsidiary opened up a new factory in Berlin, the head of the subsidiary was in the Nazi party, and they had this huge kind of ceremony with Nazi flags hanging in the factory. They had all the top Nazi officials in there. Yeah, and he gave the speech where he saw statistics and IBM as a weapon, as Hitler's, well, not a weapon, as surgical tools. So Hitler, their Führer, as the physician who goes into society and looks at its racial sort of structure,
yeah,
and finds the disease, and then it is up to, and then he uses as his tools sort of IBM tabulators to find the disease, you know, and then uses statistical analysis, which is done in conjunction with IBM technology, to cut out, you know, the rot and make the sort of German body politic, you know, healthy again. I mean, mm-hmm. So he gave this speech where he talks about himself and talks about IBM subsidiary as an instrument of the Führer and like of his desire to cleanse society, and so it's a pretty creepy, you know, pretty disturbing thing. And that was like, and of course, you know, as that book explains, IBM was actually profiting off of all of this business, even though it was already forbidden at the time from, I mean, the two countries were at war, and so. Yeah, and so there's a kind of an interesting wrinkle to that, but computer technology from the very beginning was about understanding, you know, people on a very individual level, but also on a societal level, mm-hmm. And managing that society in some way or fixing that society, and so the computers were used in a way that was in line with whatever political culture, you know, an ideology was in the country where they were being put to use, you know. And so in Nazi Germany, they were being put to use in helping purify the German population, you know, finding the Jew, finding some of the people with the smallest amount of Jewish blood in them and Jewish heritage, and then, of course, then running slave labor camps in which these Jews were sent to. And of course, you know, IBM plays a big role in just about every stage in, you know, computer development and actually internet history. I mean, so the first radar defense system was ran on IBM computers. A lot of the people who worked on that radar defense system, it was in the 1950s, went on to work for ARPA to develop the ARPANET, which then became the internet.
Which I'm going to ask you about next.
And then, and then of course, IBM was contracted to build the first commercial backbone. The federal government paid it to create the first national backbone, internet backbone, that then became part of the internet that we use today. And so, like, yeah, IBM is there from the very beginning. It's been the center of, computer and then internet development as well.
So we've been talking for almost an hour, and we haven't even gotten to the actual early iteration of the internet yet. But
I guess I'm like a gas bag, you know. Just
no, it's
a wind bag.
It's great. No, we've covered a lot of ground. I mean, I don't think most people know anything about the sort of the way this has evolved over time. So I think it's extremely fascinating. I guess just explain how the ARPA program. So explain how the ARPA program evolved into what became known as the ARPANET, and exactly what that was and how it relates to the internet today.
Well, yeah. So the ARPANET program comes out of a couple of different ARPA programs that started in 1962, and they were started by this MIT mathematician called J.C. Ehrlichleiter. He was brought in to try to figure out what kind of technology the military would need to create a modern command and control communications network. So like a kind of a modern management system for the military. And so at the time, computers were still these big boxes, you know, that like occupied entire rooms, and they were little more than giant calculators. You had to like feed stuff into them. Either like a technician, you know, you had to like write out computer code and these punch cards, you know, and then like you had give they gave that to a technician who, you know, worked with the computer, and the technician would like sit there in his lab coat and like feed that stuff in there. That'd be the program. So you code the computer, and then the computer then would run that code, and it would like spit out a result, you know. So it was a very it was like a calculator, but it was just giant. It had to be operated, you know, in a specialized language,
mm-hmm.
And operated by technicians. And so in some circles at the time, it was believed that you needed to run a global empire, a modern global military empire, you needed a new kind of communications system that could allow military commanders to sort of communicate commands and to make sure that everything's being carried out and to understand what the hell is going on in all these different places around the world. You know, you're fighting a war again. It's from Southeast Asia to Latin America. You're like, there's all these different insurgencies. You're fighting a Cold War also. There's, you know, nuclear weapons potentially. There's, you know, you're watching for nukes. You're watching for, you know, bombing raids. You're watching for missile launches. You know, all these things. Like, you have this chaotic world, and how do you know what the hell is going on? You know, until ARPA developed this sort of modern computer technology, it was all essentially done by, you know, like telephone. Mm-hmm. You call someone and be like, hey, what's going on over there?
Yeah.
And they're like, oh, well, I don't know. Let me find out. And then, you know, call up the next guy who's sitting in, you know, somewhere else. And then it goes down the line. And by the time it gets back to the general, it's like, you know, there's a game of telephone. Again, you know, you don't have a sense of what's going on in the world, you know. And so Licklider was essentially called to ARPA to figure out what kind of technology would need to be created in order to have this kind of system, because it wasn't even fathomable to a lot of people. It wasn't, you could, how do you, what computer network, computer technology would you need, you know? And so he came in and he started sort of funding different efforts through these two programs. One was called Command and Control Research, and the other one was called Behavioral Sciences. And they were interconnected. So the Command and Control Research, he started funding immediately networking projects that could connect different computers together. He started funding interactive computer projects that would create computer technology that a person could just intuitively interact with. So the stuff that we take for granted now, like the desktop or the laptop, I mean, hadn't even yet been invented. So ARPA was instrumental in underwriting research that would create these technologies. I mean, like the personal computer was created by ARPA, and it came out of this program that was started by JCR Licklider. And so he launched all these different programs, but underlying it all, you know, there was this idea that you needed to create a general purpose interactive computer technology, and then that technology could be used for whatever reason you want it to be used for. You can use it for, you know, managing and sort of a modern military. A military analyst could use it to analyze like dissident movements and to feed in information on, you know, political protesters or whatever. Or you could be a Wall Street analyst who is trying to analyze markets and predict markets. Or you could be a climate scientist and you need tools that could ingest things about, you know, data about climate, and so like these were on one level they were general purpose computer tools. But of course the reason they were being funded and an aspect of all of these programs had like military application, of course, right? And so right from the very beginning there was an interaction between the counterinsurgency part of ARPA and sort of the computer development and computer technology development side of ARPA. And so they were intermingled. So when Licklider was funding some early computer research, he was also funding like at UCLA projects that could predict the behavior of political systems and countries, that could even like model and predict human behavior and like brain processes, you know. So the idea was that you had these computer network tools that you would create and they'd be connected and people could use them, but then you also needed programs that you could run on these things that could be useful to the military and to America's sort of counterinsurgency doctrine at the mm-hmm. time. And so there was a dual track, essentially. On the one track was about creating a general purpose networked interactive computer, right, which is what we have now. And the other track was creating tools that could be useful to the military that could run on these computers, right? And these things involved, you know, like logistics systems for the Air Force that could, using the ARPANET or using these computers, they could, you could like load, you know, like a manifest, you know, so go, these are the things that we need to go to go on, you know, to out to Vietnam, and you know, you send it to an airbase that's far away. And then you could immediately communicate between different parts of the Air Force that they could send the data back and forth to each other. So it wouldn't be like calling it in on a list or mailing it, you know, which would normally have been the way that they do it by hand, by, you know, they'd call up people on the telephone and like read lists off. So you could create now a network, a computer network, and tools that the military could use on that network, right?
Of course.
Yeah. I mean, just it's pretty obvious, right? And so in the internet, in the history of the internet, most histories of the internet that you read, you get like the one track, which is the general purpose computing track. You don't get the other track of why this general purpose computer was being funded.
It's almost just like, oh, the military made this great technology and now they're just giving it away to the public.
Exactly.
I mean, that's kind of like was my understanding of the internet when I was first on it. I kind of knew a little bit about the history, but I don't think most people don't realize that there was always a motive. I mean, that there, you know, there had to have been some kind of motive. I mean,
the military is funding a technology, development of a technology for some reason. Now, that technology once comes online and becomes sort of commercially viable, you know, and becomes privatized and, you know, companies begin to produce it and whatever, then it has other aspects to it, right? It has other uses that might not be at all related to, you know, its original military purposes, you know, or might have the uses, but it might just be like there might be always a duality to it.
Mm-hmm.
But so the reason why the modern personal network computer was developed by ARPA was to give, you know, military commanders a kind of total information awareness. You know, that was at least the idea, the dream. You know, it was just when you were first beginning to develop just even the technology, you know. Like, oh, a mouse, you know, like you're taking baby steps towards that. But the dream from the beginning was to give them awareness of the world, right? And to provide tools that could ingest data from all sorts of places to analyze that data and potentially even predict future behavior, you know? Just like you could bug the battlefield. But again, at first you have to create the basic underlying technology that software could run on.
Yeah,
and so there was a dual track, and so what Licklider did in 1962, he kind of set up the program, the command and control research program, that ended up spawning the ARPANET 7 years later, and then he left and he went back to the private sector to work, and then so it kind of ground on like this program for several years until. The basic computer technology was created that could then be connected by computers by the network, and so that's when the ARPANET went online, is when you could start to connect actually technology that was developed for it, you know.
I always like it when people dig up old news, like investigative reports, especially TV news ones. And you found something in your book that I never heard about. And I'm actually wondering now if you've actually seen it, which was on June 2nd, 1975. NBC correspondent Ford Rowan, this is actually, I'm taking a quote from your book. Ford Rowan appeared on the evening news to report a stunning expose about ARPANET with and apparently something specifically about the CONUS Intel spying operation. Now, I guess just describe what this report was. When did what time period, you know, the time period that this was in was around the same time as the Church Committee or a little after. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So what, you know, what was the climate like at that time? And it actually almost seems to imagine that they would have been running a story like this back then just seems really shocking. So how did this guy even come across this information, and what was sort of the tone and the angle of this expose?
So what you're describing is a report from 1975 that talked about how the reporter discovered through a bunch of different sources, including people at the White House, several intelligence agencies, and ARPA, that the ARPANET that had been online at that point for 6 years was being used to spy on Americans, on millions of Americans. So, you know, the ARPANET became the internet, but at the time, the significance of the ARPANET was not yet apparent. You know, it'd take like another two decades for it to start to appear in most American, you know, homes. So, but what Rowan was describing back then in 1975 was that the internet, the first version of the internet, was being used to surveil Americans. And it was specifically digitizing surveillance files that had been analog surveillance files that are kept on paper and things like that, digitizing them and then putting them in a format that could be shared among intelligence agencies, and it could be processed, could be analyzed, could be you know, compiled into dossiers, could be mapped out for the social relationships and things like that. So it took intelligence that was collected, that had been collected actually in the 60s and going into the 70s, that was actually part of an illegal U.S. Army surveillance operation called CONUS Intel that was revealed in 1972, and it led to all these hearings about the illegal nature of an Army surveillance program that started in the mid-60s. And it was, the reason it was started was because the U.S. Army believed that there was a real insurgency that was happening in America, that the civil rights movement, that anti-war protesters were not like legitimate, they were not Americans who had legitimate political grievances about their about politics in America as they were happening, but that these were foreign combatants essentially, or you know, insurgents, domestic insurgents being propped up or somehow controlled by a foreign power, the Soviet Union. And so the Army initiated this nationwide massive surveillance program. That just Siri turned on while I was talking about this, just so you know. It's pretty, okay. It's pretty funny. I keep forgetting to turn it off. I don't know why I keep forgetting to turn off Siri. Must be something strange why I keep forgetting to do that. So there was this nationwide surveillance program where essentially if there was a, you know, a PTA bake sale, or like, you know, a get together at someone's home that had more than a couple of people, and there were, you know, people were talking about the civil rights movement or organizing against the war, there was one or more Army undercover agents surveilling that meeting. And so it was nationwide and involved thousands of army personnel that were, you know, like cut their, you know, try to grow up their hair and try to blend in into the sort of the radical population. And so they collected all these files, and they were collected as it would later turn out illegally, because they were not empowered to collect that kind of data on American citizens. And so it led to a bunch of actually congressional investigations in 1972, and the Army at the time promised that these files would be destroyed, that it was going to destroy all the data that it collected. It was millions of Americans at the time that they had in their files, and so that was the end of it. And what Ford Rowan, the NBC reporter at the time, discovered was that no, actually, at the exact moment that Army officials, generals, were telling congressmen that they were destroying the files, they were actually digitizing them using this new, strange kind of new networking technology and the tools that were associated with the ARPANET. So the ARPANET was used to digitize these surveillance files and make them available to any intelligence agency in America. And so it was a huge scandal when he broke the story. Of course, think for us, it has special significance because we know that the internet, you know, 30 years later turned into this giant surveillance machine. And so what his story in hindsight tells us is that surveillance was not something that was like came at some point later down the road. It wasn't like a corruption of the internet. It wasn't something that was put in by the NSA at some point because it was, you know, a corrupt government agency, or it wasn't something that Google just decided to do on its own. That surveillance of Americans was something that was baked into the technology from the very beginning. You know, going back to 1975, that was when the story was broke, but actually the digitization process happened in 1972, 3 years after the ARPANET came online. I did watch the clip, the actual footage. I saw it. It's really amazing. It was very hard to get. And what's amazing about it is it was on the evening news. It was on primetime television, talking about this surveillance network. and NBC ran two other segments looking at this network and looking very, very specifically at like the technical structure of it, why it was different from things that came before it. And the big innovation in the ARPANET, as NBC described back then, was that you didn't need a big centralized database, right? So at the time, people were worried about, you know, big central database, you know, like a government database that like that can hold everything about you, you know, can, you know, it's like, let's say it's indexed by your social security number and it has all your work record, all your employment history, your medical records, or your, you know, draft history, your criminal history, you know, your ownership records of your, you know, your DMV records. So people were really worried that the government was building such a database. And there were several attempts in the 60s that were essentially shut down or and blocked by in Congress because it was kind of scandalous at the time because people were worried about the government having too much power over people by having all this data in one place. But what ARPANET showed was that you didn't need a centralized database. It showed that what you needed is just a bunch of databases, you know, spread around all over the place in different military and intelligence agencies. All you really needed was a way to connect them together. Mm-hmm. And in fact, and that made it much more powerful because you didn't need to push through these big projects to create centralized databases. If you could share the data amongst each other, you know, like no one would even know what kind of data you really had because you transfer it, it's in a different computer. Mm-hmm. You know, if someone wants to look at and do an audit, well, you can transfer it to a different computer. It's not even on your computer anymore.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, so it's like it makes it actually much more difficult to control from a political perspective. And so they addressed that in the reporting. They said, like, look, we don't know what is actually in these computers or how many files there are because we don't have a good way of finding out because there isn't like a place that you can go to look. And so the reporting itself in 1975 caused a scandal and led to congressional investigations of computer technology, of computer surveillance technology, as they called it. And so, I was surprised when I found this. First, I found this in the congressional record because it was read into the congressional record as part of an investigation into government surveillance technology. And what really surprised me about that episode from 1975 was that you won't find it in any history of the internet. There are a bunch of histories, history books looking at the internet and looking at the origins of the internet, looking at all the colorful characters that created it, all the engineers who worked for ARPA. There are documentaries made on this, but like in nowhere will you actually find this pretty central, I think, moment in the internet's history when in 1975 it was already shown to be a surveillance tool that was spying on Americans. You know, we know that the internet is used to spy on Americans today. And it was being used to spy on Americans in 1975. So it's a pretty significant, you know, moment in history to try to understand the technology and to understand what it became today. But it's been just deep sixed. I mean, it's gone. And I was really shocked to find it. I had no idea. You know, it was just sort of like this little gem that you could sort of see sparkling. And when I followed that thread, it really gave me an alternative. Began to expose an alternative history of the internet, a thread in the history of the internet that has never really been told before.
And more on this, just sort of the secret history of the internet, because even when the NSA scandal broke after Edward Snowden, you know, I guess I should say the second major NSA scandal, because there's probably been many, many over the decades. But after the Church Committee, which also involved, you know, things about how the NSA had overreached. There was a lesser known hearing by a Senator Irvin, which you say that his committee established that the U.S. Army had amassed a powerful domestic intelligence presence and had developed a massive system for monitoring virtually all political protests in the United States. And I think you go on to mention how this guy was actually like anti-civil rights era. He was like a staunch constitutionalist, but he was actually bad on a lot of other politics, but he happened to actually stand up for something that like nobody else really seemed concerned with at the time. Am I actually jumping back, or is this something that
you're jumping a little bit back? I think you're talking about the CONUS intelligence sort of scandal.
Okay.
I think I mean, look, there's, you know, it's sort of like today on some level, because you had the kind of the conservatives, you know, kind of the libertarian-minded, you know, libertarian-oriented congressmen, you know, who were basically from the South, and they were Democrats, but, you know, they were like civil libertarians. And even though they didn't believe in civil liberties necessarily for African-Americans, you know, but like they represented, you know, the kind of the business thinking, you know, the thinking of powerful people in America and of corporate interests. And one of the things that, you know, corporations worry about is the government power, right? I mean, they don't want the government to be too powerful in certain cases. They don't want the government to have spy on America's, because it also means spying on, you know, potentially that power can be turned on corporations. It can be turned on the wealthy.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, it's surveillance is also something that is, look, the IRS and IRS audits are a form of surveillance, right? EPA monitoring of pollution levels and of, you know, around, let's say, refineries or factories, right? That's a form of surveillance.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a kind of surveillance that, you know, businesses don't like, right? So when we talk about surveillance, we always think about it something as bad and somehow, like, you know, this sort of just the aura of surveillance is, you know, can't possibly be good because it's just there's a malevolent sort of force, the big brother that watches. But surveillance is something that is actually political. So it depends on the politics, right? So surveillance could be actually a good thing when the surveillance is deployed in the service of some kind of greater good. I mean, I'm personally, you know, for making sure that rich people pay their share of taxes and more of them, you know. And so, like, you have to have some kind of surveillance power that the government has or society has that makes sure that that happens. And then, of course, if it doesn't happen, then, you know, there's some kind of punitive measures are taken, right? So surveillance is, it's interesting, you know, like surveillance has always had this sort of right wing opposition to it, you know, government surveillance. And you see that with like people like Ron Paul or Rand Paul,
mm-hmm.
that they're like against the NSA and they're against, at least in theory, against some of these programs, you know, at least rhetorically. Because I think from a business's perspective, you know, from a rich person's perspective, like, you know, like giving too much surveillance power to the government is not good. You know, it's that which means that it takes away your power as well. And so, yeah, so there was some in the hearings about illegal army surveillance, you know, it was mostly targeted in left-wing movements and anti-war protesters and things like that. But it had opposition from more conservative forces, you know, conservative elements in the Senate.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which is actually kind of in line with what we see today. You know, you have like Rand Paul, you know, opposing drones and things like that, even though he's not against drones being like used to take out people who rob liquor stores.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is it's a funny kind of thing, you know. It's like there's good drones and bad drones. Good drones take out, you know, people who, you know, take out people for petty theft. You know, the bad drones are the ones that are, I don't know, used abroad.
So there's an important turning point somewhere in this where you ask the question in your book, how did technology so deeply connected to war and counterinsurgency suddenly become a one-way ticket to global utopia? And there's a really important character here that you spend quite a bit of time on in your book named Stuart Brand. And explain who he was and also break apart that sentence a little more about what you mean, you know, how did that transition take place from it being an obviously U.S. military grown apparatus to this sort of beacon of hope and freedom and even maybe even revolution for human society.
Yeah. Well, you know, look, in 1969, you had students from MIT and Harvard come out and hold protests against the ARPANET, the network that became the internet a few decades later. So the ARPANET went online in 1969, and that same year they went out to protest it. And they protested it because they saw it as not something that was going to bring liberation to mankind, but they saw it as a weapon of influence and control. They saw it as a surveillance network that would be used by the U.S. government to attack and to neutralize sort of progressive movements around the world. And so back when the ARPANET was being created, it was seen by a lot of people in America as something that was to be resisted, something that should be stopped, because if it was allowed to run its course, it would create the beginnings of a surveillance society, right? And yet, if you go 30 years into the future from that moment, from like, so this is 1969 to 1999, right? You get something completely different. You get people cheering on the spread of the internet. You get people cheering on the internet as something that's going to revolutionize the world and make the world a better place. It's going to equalize power between individuals and corporations and governments. It's going to create global direct democracy where we wouldn't even need to have governments mediating our interaction, right? Because we'd have direct rule on a global level. You'd get rid of like corruption because everything would be transparent. You have technological innovation based on this network that would basically eradicate poverty, all these things. It was going to create a utopia. So you went from, you know, people in 1969 looking at the ARPANET and computer networks in general and computer technology in general as tools of power, to 30 years later having the same exact tools, having the same exact web technologies seen as something as liberatory and utopian. So like, in 30 years, like there was a radical shift in the way that people looked at computer technology. And so, you know, it's a very interesting and somewhat complicated story that involves a lot of different forces that went into it. But in essence, you know, that the idea that society had about technology was rebranded, you know, and was when computers became big business and when the internet started becoming a big business, it was rebranded into something completely different from what it was. They rebranded a military technology built by military contractors into a tool of democracy and egalitarianism. And one of the central characters in the story, one of the sort of original rebranders of the internet was this guy named Stuart Brand. Pretty cool guy, pretty interesting guy. He's still alive. He lives on a houseboat in South Salido.
Did you speak to him?
I got in touch with him, and he declined to be interviewed for the book, mm-hmm. Which is not surprising. I mean, because one of the things that I wanted to ask him was, you're a central player in helping reshape people's idea of technology as something liberatory and utopian, and something, the tool that was going to empower the individual and create a better world. How do you look at that in hindsight now that you know what the internet has become? You know, do you think that you're wrong? Where do you think you went astray, or where do you think the internet's promise went astray? Mm-hmm. Maybe I should have sugarcoated my interview request to him a little
bit. Was it a kinder version of what you actually ended up asking him? What you just said?
Well,
sounds,
I mean,
pretty nice.
I think I made it slightly even more vague, you know. But I asked him directly, like, because yeah. Look, the internet has become what it's become. You know, it's become, you know, a monopolized telecommunications infrastructure that mediates, you know, more and more of our life, and it's at its core, it's a surveillance machine, right? And it's controlled by these very undemocratic forces, and it's birthed some of the most powerful people in the world. It's created wealth and concentrated wealth the kind that we haven't seen since the railroad barons, you know. And so that's obvious, you know, to anyone who looks at the technology, you know, looks at the reality. And so, but he presented the internet going back to, you know, to the early 70s as something that was going to actually destroy this world. It wasn't going to recreate it in a much more concentrated fashion, you know, that it was actually going to destroy the corporate world, this sort of concentrated corporate capitalism. So yeah, he wouldn't talk to me, but that's okay. I mean, I didn't expect him to be honest. And so he was interesting because he's a guy who hung out with the merry pranksters. He dropped acid. He was best known for creating the Whole Earth Catalog, which was the sort of hippie Bible at the time, the Bible of the commune movement. It was like this sort of self-help, guide to the commune lifestyle. So like you had like suggestions on how to build a commune, what kind of structures to use, what kind of tools you needed. You had like advice columns for from one commune, you know, to another. And it was like reading suggestions that included, you know, like Norbert Wiener's Cybernetics alongside Ayn Rand's The Fountainhead, or, and and it was this, he was sort of this promoter and promoter of this lifestyle, right, of a counterculture that was believed that politics is dead. They didn't want to engage with politics, like the New Left was doing, or like civil rights activists were doing. They didn't want to engage with the old system to reform it and to make it better. They wanted to say, they said, it's uncurable. Like, the only way to really fix society is to create a new one. And they wanted to create a new society based on like a technological foundation that was kind of like a early version of the internet, you know? Like, they believed that they could use modern technology to create a fair society. And so he was very well known for publishing the Whole Earth Catalog, and that it was a very influential magazine, and like and he, in the end, like that world, the commune world, was actually overlapped with the ARPA military contractor world, because in a way that they were both chasing the same dream on some level, right? So the commune world wanted to create these new small scale societies that were based on new kind of decentralized ideas, like that you wouldn't have a commune wouldn't be hierarchical. Everyone would be equal to everybody else, that you would have this sort of direct democracy on a local level, you know, on a commune level. And, you know, the some of the engineers who were creating the ARPANET were thinking the same, along the same lines, but they were thinking on a global scale. You're going to create this global telecommunication system that could allow people to communicate directly and create a digital global kind of commune. Flat power, flat hierarchies and things like that. And so there was an overlap. And so he brought his sort of commune idea of the world to the ARPANET world, to the ARPA world, to ARPANET contractors. And he's presented them in terms of not as like military contractors who are helping the military build a modern command and control technology for the military, but they were actually radicals who were creating technology that would make the military obsolete, that would actually, you know, that would put it out of business. Because if this networking technology would actually spread around the world, they would, you know, foster a time of global peace, and there would be no need for militaries or anything like that. So they were, in a way, the military was being taken for a ride, because these guys got themselves somehow inside the ARPA, and they were military contractors building the ARPANET, yet they were actually more radical than the anti-war protesters who were putting their lives on the line and protesting, because they were thinking about the future. They were thinking about a new way of living, that politics and like political parties, political candidates, all this stuff, like organizing on this kind of human level and reforming the system, was like unnecessary. There's, because there was going to be a new world afoot, a global commune, digital commune.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so he was very central to...
It sounds nice in a way. Yeah, we can see, especially during that era, I'm trying to put myself back. I was born long after that, but just in that mindset, it sounds very utopian.
Yes, sounds great. I mean, and that his vision was really central, because I think his vision, is ultimately the vision that Wired magazine promoted, and is ultimately the vision that we still live with today. You know, thinking of the internet as this global platform that allows people to communicate with each other, that allows us to bypass traditional power structures, and to elevate, you know, individual power to the level of like what would we normally associate with big powerful corporations or, you know, governments and things like that. And so yeah, it sounds great. The problem was, of course, that it that vision of the internet, right, and vision of the ARPANET, and vision of that technology, what it did is it ignored the power that actually stood right underneath the ARPANET and ARPA, and the military power that was financing it. And so you can only, you know, believe in that vision if you ignored power. If you only saw just the top layer of that technology, you know, and you didn't think about how it was going to be used once it was built. And because things are always, power always uses whatever tools are there to enhance its own power. Mm-hmm. And so it was this idea that this technology was somehow neutralized power. But it ignored the nature of power, you know, the nature of economic power, because it thought that the technology would be what affected power, not the other way around, you know. That they thought the technology had power on its own, but it doesn't. Technology only has power in as much as it's used by it, or not. Or used by some part of society.
Yeah.
So if there was a popular democratic movement that was really powerful, that was the driving force of a society, yeah, the internet could have maybe gone that way. But when you have a national security state, the Cold War, and concentrated capital and Wall Street as the things that are driving society, even if it's a decentralized system, as they envision the internet, like, that the decentralized system would not reform those powerful forces. It would be used by those powerful forces to propagate and to promote their own power. And so, I think it was that it's a naive politically. It sounds nice, but in the end, it's very dumb and naive, because it doesn't actually think very deeply about the nature of power and how it affects the world,
Pushing the timeline forward a little bit, when you get into the 1980s in your book, it's just really interesting to me how at least just the culture from that time was so, in a lot of ways, had reverted from the 70s, or just society's understanding of how bad the U.S., what evil the U.S. government was capable of and things like that. There were a lot of myths in the 80s kind of in some ways had resembled a little bit like the 1950s in terms of our popular culture. Mm-hmm. And, even Apple, you mentioned this, that they had a commercial that was basically a parody of 1984, sort of explaining that their computers would sort of liberate you from the IBM first Apple IIe with some kind of liberating.
It's a direct line from Stuart Brand's idea of what computers are and computer networks are, mm-hmm. to Apple. I mean, in fact, what's his name? Steve Jobs was a huge fan of, as a kid, he read, he's a little younger, so he read the whole Earth catalog. As a kid, he didn't participate in the commune movement, but he, to him, it was like a Bible. Mm-hmm. Because to him, it showed that you could create a new society using these sort of small-scale technologies, to create a commune that's separate from the world, that's basically off the grid. Mm-hmm. And you could use modern technology to create a modern off-the-grid small commune and community, and so he saw this magazine that showed you all the cool furnaces and all the cool new geodesic dome technology that you could use to build your utopia out in New Mexico somewhere. He was really he explained that it was a powerful influence on him, and it inspired him when he thought about Apple computer, and when he essentially envisioned and the way that he thought about Apple computer was very much in those terms, in Stuart Brand's terms. And yeah, the first ad that they put out, which is basically this colorful woman in a 80s kind of haircut, like 80s sort of fitness totally. Babe kind of, was running with a sledgehammer and runs into this movie theater where everyone's being are zombies and watching this, Big Brother on the screen. She smashes the screen, and she's Apple computer, and these are the regular kind of, people in America, and that Apple computer will help to smash Big Brother and wake everybody up. And they were kind of black and white and gray.
Yeah.
And then suddenly they were, I think, became color.
Which is interesting juxtaposition from how I remember them advertising. I don't know if you remember this, when the G4 processors first came out, they advertised it by bragging that it was technology that was used by the U.S. military.
Oh, I don't remember.
And they had tanks driving up to the G4 tower.
Wow.
Something like that. But it was using military imagery to advertise the This was the after the power PC processor, so yeah. It was like the next generation.
Wow.
But you also mentioned in the, and correct me if I'm wrong, but also in the year 1984 was William Gibson's Neuromancer novel.
Yeah.
And that coined the term cyberspace, but it was also a novel, and I haven't read it, so correct me if I'm wrong on this again, that it was also, it was showing you how both sides of this potential future of the internet could be used for a sort of like good and evil. Right?
Like I'd say it was all evil in there because, I mean, it's, really? It's okay. Interesting because it became the Bible of the cyberpunk movement.
Yeah.
Because it defined this sort of aesthetic, cyberpunk, you know, your sort of digital, like hybrid cyborg, you know, cool, like samurai swords embedded in your titanium skeleton modification, you know, with like uplinks and, you know, virtual reality uplinks in your spine, all this stuff. Like it was taken up by the subculture as something cool, like kind of like Mad Max, you know, that like the post-apocalyptic aesthetic, like was taken up as something cool by the burner, you know, movement, you know.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
It's like, oh yeah, man, it's post-apocalyptic, bro. Yeah. Let's go party, you know. It's like, wait, it's supposed to be a dystopia, guys. Yeah, yeah. You know, like, and so it's the same thing, I think, with Gibson's novel, in that like he was looking at it as a dystopia.
Yeah.
Like he said, I mean, in his interviews about it, he would talk about how he said, like my kind of was thinking about if you take Reaganomics, you know, and like you project it forward into the future and you see it develop into this, you know, into a world where, you know, everything's dominated by these computer systems and we live in these virtual realities and like what would it look like? And it was a pretty brutal world, you know, where it's all, there's no law other than power, you know, and things existed in cyberspace in this virtual reality world, but at the same time it was sort of, you know, intermixed with the real world. And like there was no real law, you know, there was no order. It was just like what you can get away with, you know. It's like there was these giant corporations who had their giant, you know, artificial intelligence units that like protected the corporation and its interest. And if you tried to like hack into him and like steal some secrets, it would like, you know, fry your brain and kill you. And so there was no like accountability other than just sort of like raw power. And then the sort of the sneaky rebels and sort of these sort of, you know, like people who are like working for murky forces, then, or maybe some of them are working for themselves. Anyway, he took it to this logical extreme and like to show how like what a dystopia, but maybe kind of cool dystopia, you know, but like still pretty dark place.
Yeah.
And so, he took it. It was interesting, yeah, because on the one hand, you had like the utopian Apple computer, and then the dystopian science fiction that was already predicting, you know, something that we're actually coming close today. Because all right, we're not like all jacking into virtual reality systems, right? But in that world, in Gibson's world, like you weren't ever sure who is who, like, because everything could be like a virtual manifestation of something. Everything could be reprogrammed. So the person you're dealing with, you know, might have like, you know, someone else standing behind them, and you're really not sure who, you know, what people's interests are or who they're working for. In cyberspace, everything is virtual. You know, everything can be faked. Everything can be reprogrammed. And in a way, we're kind of living in that world now because, you know, with the Russian hacks, like, and Russian cyber operations and all these things, like, we don't really know if any of that happened. You know, we don't know if they've been faked. We don't know if, you know, like what the attacks are, because we have no handle on them. You know?
Yeah.
We just only see the reporting on it and like some information leaked by intelligence agencies about them. And so like everything's virtual. We don't know. We're clearly being manipulated on some level by forces we can't really see, or we can at least guess at them because sometimes they're pretty obvious and apparent. But like he what's great about his novel, I think, is that like he not a big fan of it, but I think it's pretty interesting, is that like he predicted the virtual nature of that and like how everything is kind of a cyber, you know, it's like a psyops in a way, because you're never sure what the hell is going on. Mm-hmm. Because everything is virtual. But that was taken up and celebrated by this new like generation of libertarian sort of computer nerds who like the idea of themselves as like these sort of digital samurais, you know, who are like modified their bodies, you know, and like got all these like cool mods and got like, you know, got like swords coming out of their wrists, and like they can like, you know, have, you know, specialized like skeletons that are, can't be broken. You know, they got like laser eyes. They can like tap into systems, you know, because they have like a shunt in their spine. You know, they like to see themselves as that because it's cool. They're all wearing trench coats, you know. They're all doing crazy kung fu moves, right?
Yeah.
Right? They're like battling these powerful, you know, artificial intelligence entities and they're winning, right? Like, it's like they like to see themselves as that. They're listening to industrial music, you know?
Uh-huh.
and so even though it was a dystopia, it like defined actually in a positive way this new generation of libertarian, pretty cynical kind of libertarian hacker culture, right?
Mm-hmm.
That saw everything as a kind of, as a power play. And that, like, where the smart hackers win, where the clever ones win, where you do have some power if you're a clever hacker, and if you're like, and I think that that culture, you know, birthed like people like Julian Assange, you know, in a big way, just on some level, because you can kind of win,
mm-hmm.
or at least score some points against these powerful entities by using these computer systems to get into them, to like steal secrets, to expose them, right?
Yeah,
I mean, and so. So on the one hand, like, yeah, there's like a dystopian quality, but it's still held up as something actually positive because it, I don't know, like WikiLeaks culture and leaker culture isn't like a dystopian culture. It believes that if you liberate secrets from these powerful institutions, you can change the world for the better.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You spend a lot of time in your book talking about Wired magazine and its origins. And I'm really glad that you did, because it's something that, growing up in the Bay Area and being familiar with Silicon Valley, it always sort of bothered me how sort of utopian and uncritical it was of like the private sector, especially during around the time of like when Google and those kinds of things exploded. And, you know, magazines like Wired would sort of lead society to believe that Google wasn't evil and things like that. You know, when, yeah. At the time, Google had the "don't be evil" mantra.
Hey, we should trust people, you know, when they say
yeah.
things. Trust corporations when they say things.
So what is it about Wired that you think is so important for this sort of shift in our acceptance of... Actually, I skipped over something, but tell me... So before we move on to Wired, explain when the ARPANET went from being, you know, just the U.S. Army's network of supercomputers, as you call it, to something that's actually... you know, partly plugged into the civilian world.
Well, it happened in the 80s with the creation of the NSFNet, which was created by the National Science Foundation as a kind of an upgrade to the ARPANET system, and like that would bring it into the civilian world. So NSFNet connected all these different universities and research institutions in the 80s, and it was created by the National Science Foundation as like a national network, and they created it. You know, it would connect to the ARPANET and to the old ARPANET because it's the same architecture. Then with explicit goal of privatizing it as soon as it became commercially viable, as soon as there were enough customers on it, enough business on it, that companies could make money by taking over portions of the networks as internet service providers. And so... that process began in late 80s, in 1986, and terminated in 1994 when the NSFNet was fully privatized. And when the NSFNet became fully privatized, it became the internet. So today the internet, of course, is much bigger because it's been improved, it's been upgraded, it's vastly more, it's much bigger now than it was in 1984 when it was privatized. But the core of it, on which everything else then grew, was... a privatized public infrastructure project,
mm-hmm.
that was explicitly created to be privatized, which is another part of the history of the internet that almost no one knows about, and I didn't know about it, you know, until I started really trying to explain and understand how the transition from a military network to a fully commercial system that we use today, how it happened, because there's like a black hole in our understanding of the history. The internet, you think like, oh yeah, it's emerged from the Pentagon maybe at some point a long time ago, sure, but then like, you know, it got out somehow and then like it became the internet.
Yeah.
But like, what was that process?
Yeah.
And as I found out, you know, it was very deliberate. You know, they took this technology and they wanted to, the federal government wanted to create a civilian network, but the federal government didn't want it to be government run,
yeah,
eventually, and so it was created you know, in a way that could make it easy to privatize once the time came. And that's what happened. And in fact, I amazingly talked to this guy, and I was like, I kind of almost like asked him half jokingly, you know, the question, like, he's this manager for the National Science Foundation who used to work for the U.S. Army, connecting U.S. Army supercomputers to the ARPANET. And then he was hired by the National Science Foundation to design a civilian version of that kind of network and then to privatize it. And I asked him when I got reached him, I said, like, you know, is it right to refer to you as the man who privatized the internet? And I, like, expected him to, you know, say, oh, no, of course not. What are you talking about? Instead, he said, yeah, that's right. So there's a guy who privatized the internet and we don't even know his name.
You know? Yeah.
And which, you know, to me, as someone who was born in Russia, born in the Soviet Union, it's very surprising because, you know, most Russians today, even the young ones, even the people who were probably too young to even remember the privatization process, they still know at least a couple of names of the people who were involved in that, mm-hmm. or the people who privatized their national wealth, you know. But for the internet, you know, it's arguably the most important invention, government invention of the 20th century. I mean, it's clearly a hugely important technology that underlies so much of our life. Like, no one knows, A, that it was actually privatized, and B, who the people who privatized this network were. And, you know, and this is, like, kind of astounding, you know, the ignorance here. And I include myself into that as well. It's not passing judgment. I'm just saying it was shocking to me how such a vital piece of history, you know, recent history, has been lost and totally buried. I was like, I walked around shocked for weeks after I found out about this, and then I like, you know, actually then got the guy to agree to an interview, and I talked to him for hours about it, and he was quite open about his role and what the federal government did, so, like, you know, there's a whole series of sub histories about the internet that we have no idea about, and but it's time that we try to get some of that stuff back. That's Siri again, just randomly turning on. What did you find out? Oh, look.
What did Siri say?
Here's what I found on the web for mysteries about the inner.
The inner?
I guess it's mysteries. I guess you meant histories of the internet, is what
That's
I said.
Great.
Thank you, Siri.
No problem.
Yeah, my theory on that is that the Siri is meant to make us think that speech to text stuff is not great and perfect yet.
Uh-huh.
So it's like, oh, she didn't hear what I said. Oh, yeah. Oh, silly Siri. She thought I said this and I meant this, but I bet you the shit that, like, they're actually operating on is, like, flawless.
It's pretty good though. Like, if you actually, yeah. if you actually, like,
no, it is. Yeah.
I like, if you try to dictate a note,
yeah,
it works like nine letters out of 10, like, perfect. I mean, you can go, you know, a couple of sentences and it understands you perfectly. Mm-hmm. I mean, now it's obviously, you know, it's, but yeah, it's pretty funny when it turns on, you know, you're reminded always, like, what the fuck, there's a bug right here, you know, it's funny. I mean, I don't know if you have any of these things in your home, but it's like everywhere I go now, you get these, like, you know, Echo dots, or, you know, like the Amazon Alexa little towers.
I don't.
Everybody has them. It's kind of weird. Yeah, and they're kind of useless too, because, like, people talk to them and they're like, they're not really, you know, like, they want you want to turn on the lights or turn down the volume or whatever, but they don't really, like, understand you very well. So you just have people get really frustrated with them. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's really, it's like, what the hell is the point of this?
No, the only thing I have close to that is I have smart lights.
Where
they're connected through my Wi-Fi network just in this room.
Oh.
So I have, like, I can,
What do you, yeah. Oh, hell yeah. You get the mood light on there.
Yes. So that's as smart as my home gets.
So you get, it's like, it's a disco light.
Yeah.
Is that on your menu? On your Mac right there? Wow.
Yeah.
It's pretty funny.
So, it's pretty funny. And now I can't find the regular one that we were using before, but. Here, let's go with Tropical Twilight.
It's not bad.
Oh man,
which one is this?
I don't know. That's one of my own presets. Okay, that's close to normal. So I mean, I've always felt that Wired magazine played a really big role in sort of the shift in our acquiescence towards technology, especially towards like companies like Google and just that, you know, whole era in general. So
yeah.
You say Wired's impact was not just cultural, but was political. Give me some of the backstory on Wired magazine and why you think it was so important for the sort of this utopian or just not being fearful of technology companies. And who's the founder? Like what are the origins of it? Who's behind it?
Well, I mean, yeah, I mean, look, Wired magazine is like, if this Wired magazine didn't exist, another one would. It existed, you know. I think there was a cultural movement at the time, you know, a cultural force where computers were suddenly big business, you know, in all sorts of ways.
Mm-hmm.
You know, on personal computing was a huge business. It was exploding, and this industry needed, you know, a public relations division. You know, needed a market. We needed marketing. It needed like. You know, a whole ecosystem of magazines, of journalists, of writers, to promote the lifestyle. You know, of a computer lifestyle, the computerized lifestyle. It's like, you know, it's like it's like selling washing machines or selling automobiles or selling, you know, cigarettes. You know, like you need there was money to be made, and of course there was gonna be entities that were gonna emerge that would. Do that to provide computers with a radical aura, with something that, you know, that was to pitch them to people as something that would make life easier, make life better, make life more enjoyable. That would open up these new vistas for you. That would make you a connected, you know, citizen. That would allow you to do all these cool things. And so Wired was just the kind of a. You know, a magazine that appeared in the 90s. It was started by this Louis Rossetto, who was who was like a college Republican in the 60s in Columbia University. You know, while you know most people in Columbia were against the Vietnam War and engaged in radical politics. He was like campaigning for Nixon, you know, and he was just sort of this like. Old school, you know, early 1960s libertarian who got into the publishing business in Europe and started writing for some computer publications and realized that, like, oh wait, what the world needs now, this is in the late 80s, what the world needs is like a computer lifestyle magazine. And so he put together this like, you know, mock-up for Wired as a magazine that does journalism in traditional sense, but really like a lifestyle magazine that promotes a lifestyle and promotes a product, and very much connected to the industry that it promotes. And so he went out on the road and like tried to find investors in America, and he couldn't really find investors for whatever reason. But he did find someone who was interested in this guy named Nicholas Negroponte, who was a really rich Greek American who came from a very wealthy Greek family. His brother John Negroponte was a Reagan official in the Reagan administration who basically served as a conduit for funds to the Contras, who fought the Sandinistas in Nicaragua, the sort of this left wing Sandinista government. In Nicaragua, so he's connected to the military establishment. He himself was a longtime ARPA contractor who worked on projects connected to the ARPANET,
mm-hmm.
and worked on projects actually with a counterinsurgency component. And by the early 90s, he kind of he rebranded himself and started this outfit in MIT called MIT Media Lab. So what it did is it took these new computer technologies that were created by ARPA, and he tried to find sort of commercial applications for them. And MIT Media Lab was sort of this privatized think tank from MIT that took corporate sponsorship and any corporation that sponsored and became a partner of MIT Media Lab would be given free use of the technology that the Media Lab created. And so they did early work in you know, like virtual reality, a lot of like new kind of internet media stuff, that technologies that that were developing at the time. And so he created this like private public like think tank that would develop computer technology that media companies could use. And so like just about every TV network in America was a partner, was an investor in it, like a bunch of Japanese media companies. So he was this sort of like, I don't know, a guy who was able to monetize on some of the contractor work that he did and to create a thriving R&D business for corporations. And he also became this guru who was seen as a guru who could predict the future, who could see where the technology was taking us. And so he was like a favorite in TED Talks. And so he was a big personality in the early 90s, and they cornered him and they somehow got him to agree to underwrite the magazine. And so he was their main investor and was able to bring in other investors because of his name. And it like it blew up from there. I mean, they became like it was like a viral hit, Wired magazine. They immediately they kind of positioned themselves not as journalists really, because they were never critical of technology. From the beginning, they were more like the public relations arm of the personal computer industry. And their very first cover story was actually about the military. And they wrote this glowing profile of a DARPA program that created a virtual reality computer game, but for tank simulations. and so they talked about how this is the future of of warfare, and how this is the future of the world. Look how cool it is. So from the very beginning, they melded the sort of computer radicalism with military technology and promoting military technology as actually also something very radical and cool. So they kind of set the tone for computer journalism as it even exists today still, I think. I mean, this idea that most computer journalism isn't very critical of the computer industry, of the computer industry that it covers.
Yeah.
It's usually, traditionally be called, marketing. It'll be the public relations division of a computer industry group of some kind, like the Computer Association of America. You actually look at Vice Magazine, and its coverage of technology is very, very uncritical.
Mm-hmm.
There might be some criticism, but it's very mild. And actually, something like, The Verge. What are some other tech publications that are read today? You have Vice, Motherboard, right? You have mm-hmm. The Verge, you have Wired Magazine, you have... there's got to be some other ones.
Gizmodo.
Yeah. And anything of like, they all kind of share the same kind of outlook. They're very excited about any kind of new military technology that comes out. They're usually online with any kind of war that's happening. They're usually very much in line with and on board with whatever new technology is being rolled out by Google or Facebook or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And they always usually take these companies for at their word.
Yeah.
Like whatever they say is like you just print it uncritically and not really analyzed. Wired was like a trendsetter, and the people who helped put it together, its early editors, were actually proteges of Stuart Brand, and Stuart Brand was himself like a columnist in Wired magazine. So there's a direct connection between Stuart Brand, the Whole Earth Catalog, and Wired magazine. I mean, they're like part of the same kind of cultural movement that brought the hippie counterculture commune into the digital age.
Mm-hmm.
But it was never really critical of power, was never really critical of American foreign policy, and was usually pretty right-wing and libertarian. I mean, Stuart Brand himself was like a pretty hardcore anti-communist, that was like, in his diaries, he wrote about how he was like, that was his big fear when he was a kid, it's like to be invaded by the Soviet Union and made into this kind of robotic commie that has no free will and is told to march in like lockstep, with everybody else, and like that, basically afraid that his individuality would be taken away by mm-hmm. this sort of you know, malevolent force that was there. And,
you know, a lot happened in between the foundation of Wired magazine and where we are today. But just touch on a few other things that are sort of hot topics right now in, you know, this argument of privatized internet overreach or surveillance. You bring up the Electronic Frontier Foundation in your book. And, you know, growing up in the Bay Area and knowing what I knew maybe like 10 years ago, I thought that the EFF was really, really good. I remember even someone from the EFF, they didn't reach out to me, but they put me in, someone tried to put me in touch with someone from the EFF about when I made the fake beheading video, because they felt that someone at the EFF might represent me if I got prosecuted. They probably wouldn't have, now looking back on it. You know, people like Mark Klein, I met him. He was actually one of the only private sector whistleblowers in this whole ongoing NSA scandal. I met him at a hearing between the EFF and the federal government in Oakland. It's a series of these ongoing hearings that are still going on. And I remember just even at the hearing getting this impression that it almost just seemed like the EFF was going through the rigmarole of this and at the same time not going after, like, private sector spying. And then I, you know, found out from, I think even it was from reading some of your stuff maybe, about just how much money they had already taken from companies like Google, and that they were already taking a lot of money from companies that were already, you know, had troubling relationships with the federal government.
Yeah.
Like, what do you think of an organization like that? Is it, I mean, is it too hyperbolic to say it's like sort of a wolf in sheep's clothing, or is it something, is it more complicated than that?
Well, I mean, it's a corporate think tank, you know, it's a corporate think tank. And I think it's a corporate think tank that's its main objective is to appear as a grassroots organization, but that in reality is wholly carrying water for its corporate donors, and it's, and so it, you call it an astroturf group, you know. Mm-hmm. And I think that while this might sound kind of out there and a bit like unbelievable, you know, to maybe some of your listeners, like, because like, what do you mean the EFF is an astroturf group? Well, I think it is that. I mean, it is that if you actually look at its finances. And I think that in some years, maybe 10 years from now, we will look at it no differently than we look at like Freedom Works or some other kind of like, or Cato Institute, you know. We won't look at it any differently. We will see that it's just, or like AEI, you know, mm-hmm. or the Heritage Foundation, or the Brookings Institute, you know, for that matter, like any other kind of corporate group, right? That represents the interests of some kind of its corporate sponsors. I mean, because it's completely funded by Silicon Valley, right? And so, of course, it's going to represent its interests, but its power lies in convincing us that it has our interests in that it cares about our interests, and that the interests of average Americans is actually in line with the interests of Silicon Valley corporations like Google and Facebook.
Yeah.
And so it's actually very insidious in that sense of like convincing us to identify ourselves, our own interests, with the interests of these giant companies that are actually manipulating us and are making money off of us and are surveilling us and that are partnering with the national security state and that are, you know, extremely powerful politically and economically, obviously, and derive that power from their ability to spy on us with impunity.
Mm-hmm.
And EFF's major contribution in the sort of post-Snowden era is to redirect people's worries about surveillance away from the private sector and into only just government surveillance, right? So
exactly, yeah.
It never cares about Google surveillance. It never talks about it. Just, you know, search through its archives, you know. EFF does not care about Google spying on its users with impunity. Mm-hmm. It does not want to even bring attention to that. It doesn't. But the one thing it does worry about is like, I don't know, like sometimes bad security at you know, some of these companies like Equifax or whatever, you know, that, and then like, oh, it's this bad corporate actor, you know, you should really have protected your system better. Why are you leaking all this all this, you know, user data online. But like the actual business of surveillance, the underlying business that powers Silicon Valley is not criticized or even talked about, if ever. And so it does some okay work sometimes, you know. It's not like all bad, but like I think it is in the end sets the privacy movement and sets people's political awareness about Silicon Valley back, you know, and really retards our development, because it restricts people's idea of what is privacy and to just government. And I think that's one of its biggest sort of contributions to our culture, is that it's a very negative contribution. And, you know, and of course it promotes purely technological means of protecting our privacy, purely technical means of protecting our privacy, like the Signal, messaging app or the Tor project. It's that is its solution to surveillance online, and not trying to actually rein in the power of these Silicon Valley companies and the power to surveil us with no control at all. You know, like, it's weird, I think, that we allow a company like Google to collect data on every part of our life. You know, I mean, would we have the same position if it wasn't Google doing this, but Philip Morris? If it wasn't Google doing this, but it was Koch Industries, could read us like an open book. Mm-hmm. We understand that those companies are very politically motivated. They have these owners, they're politically motivated, and they are trying to shape society and its laws in their favor, right? Now, if a company has that much data on, you know, American voters, and those voters determine the fate, the political fate of these companies, would we have any illusions that these companies would not put that data to use somehow? Would not turn the data that they have on us against us in some way? Would use it against us actually as a weapon? I mean, are Google and Facebook doing that? Are they actually using the vast amount of behavioral data that they have on us to actually influence us somehow? You know, and influence us to vote against our own interests, to think of against our own interests, because these companies are very, very, they are vulnerable. They're vulnerable to antitrust legislation. They're vulnerable to privacy legislation. So, if there was any kind of privacy legislation passed in America that limited the amount of information that these companies could collect on us, their value would tank. Their business would suffer, and yeah. So it's in their interest to keep us not thinking about the surveillance that they carry out, but to keep us sort of thinking about only the sort of like government structures that might be spying on us. I mean, the question is, and they've been very effective in doing that, you know, kind of incredibly, surprisingly effective, you know, to the point where like no one even thinks about that at all.
Yeah.
And so, I don't know. I don't have any information about this, and we it's very hard to see inside those companies and to get a sense of how they're using that data, aside from, you know, maybe increasing the efficiency of their targeting advertising campaigns, because Silicon Valley hasn't had its Edward Snowden. No one's come forward, you know. No one's risked their livelihood, mm-hmm. To like expose the inner workings of these companies and expose the inner workings of how they use the data that they amass on us.
That's true.
You know, yeah.
We haven't really had any serious whistleblowers from inside Google.
No, or any of the private
There's been
companies.
Leaks. You know, there's been occasional leaks of certain single aspects. Like there was a leak about how they were making money, ad money on the back of questionable sites that could be construed as child pornography.
Yeah.
That was like, so there's things like that come out, but nothing on the level of what you're talking about.
And I mean, look, you know, these, I remember like Eric Schmidt joking at some conference, where he did get a question about like, oh, like, I mean, you have all this data, like you got to be using it in some way to, you know, to boost like Google's bottom line, like, you know, not in just advertising, but he's like, well, yeah, you know, we got together at one moment and at one point we like said, yeah, we should, yeah, we can. We have all this data. Like, we can predict flus. Can we like predict the markets? And then he's like, oh, we should do that. And it's like, oh well, you know. And then there's like, oh, that'll probably be illegal. So because they would have be using insider information too.
Yeah.
And so, we can't do that, you know. So we decided to just drop the matter altogether. It's like, wait, what?
That's really fascinating.
So you know, it's... Wow. if Eric Schmidt says it's true, you know, it's like... I mean, I can't imagine them using it in some way, right? And because... they're sitting on information about people... that of a kind of information, you know, that has never existed in the history of mankind. No corporation has ever had such a clear look at the people, who decide this corporation's fate in a democracy. You know,
yeah.
The liberal idea is that we make decisions based on informed, informed. We make informed decisions, right? We learn about the world. We make informed decisions about it. Then we cast our votes in elections based on the information that we've got about the world. And so we're sort of rational voters, you know. But what happens when we live in a world mediated by the very companies that are trying to influence us? What happens in a world where we get all our news from Google and Facebook, where the news that we see is mediated by their black box algorithms? When those algorithms, and what happens in a world where those companies that we over which we have over which have power are actually trying to influence us directly in order for us to not pay attention to them at all? And I don't know. Do they use that information in some way? I think it'd be pretty naive to think that they don't. But we just have no idea about any of this. Speaking of influence campaigns, and Russia, we live in an influence campaign.
Mm-hmm.
Every time you go on Google, you are in an influence campaign, potentially. Yeah. Every time you go on Facebook, you are in an influence campaign. Twitter, too, increasingly, because with their little promoted, their timelines that is now out of whack and is based on some kind of algorithmic thing. So so they have all the power there, and we have we have no democratic leverage over anything that they do. They're completely beyond accountability or regulation at this point. So, I don't know. Yeah, EFF doesn't look at that at all. It just cares about the NSA looking, and metadata or whatever. Some very basic things that are important, but are very, a sliver of what's actually going on.
So without putting you on the hot seat and asking you for what is the solution to all this, I guess a better question would be, what do you think, how do you think people should be seeing this right now? And is there any, if encryption, using Signal and Tor is, in my opinion, I don't know how much you share this, but it's bad advice of how to deal with it. What do you think is a good, some kind of recourse we could have? Yeah. Just be completely getting off the grid?
Well, I don't know. There's no need to be paranoid about it, this is the world that we live in, the internet is not something that is apart from the world. It's not something that we can tackle on its own, right? The internet is what it is now. It's dominated by spies, and it's dominated by powerful corporations.
Mm-hmm.
Because our world is dominated by that.
Yeah.
Because you don't need to be on the internet to be in a world that's dominated by those forces. You just walk out of your house.
Yeah.
And those forces are the most powerful forces in society right now. They are the driving forces. They are what makes the world kind of go around. And we are. We can't even get healthcare, what most people in America want. We can't even get basic things, we have no power. The internet, we live in a world dominated by spies, dominated by giant corporations, and in a world in which we have no political power to even enact basic, necessary goods, healthcare.
Mm-hmm.
So why would the internet be any different? Why would the internet be any different from the real world that we inhabit? The internet is dominated by spies, dominated by powerful corporations, and it's a place where we have no power, just like the world that's outside your doorstep. So, I think the solution is actually kind of obvious, but at the same time, it's hard and extremely difficult because it will be part of some kind of bigger political solution for the world, and it can't be apart from it. And so, you know, that's why I think these things like Tor and Signal, aside from, you know, the whole like problem of them being funded by the U.S. government and them being deployed as tools of regime change and soft power, there's the political component, which is that, you know, people clearly care about their privacy and clearly worry that there are these countable forces on the internet that can spy on you and you have no real power to do anything about it. So they're drawn to a technological solution because it's the only one that seems to be available. But what happens is that people that actually worry about this and think about this are driven into doing something that actually has no effect on anything. They're given a false sense of privacy. They are given a false sense that they're actually doing something to make the world a better place and taking, you know, personal responsibility for the world. But in reality, they're just not doing anything at all. And in fact, they're just sucking away whatever energy there is to whatever energy there is for a real privacy movement gets sucked out, you know, into and redirected into these useless avenues. Because, you know, people only have so much energy to think about things during the day. And like, if they care about privacy, well, here's a solution. It's Tor. Here's a solution. It's Signal. It's like, oh, I checked that button. Like, I can rest easy now. I've done something. But that is a false sense of political action because you have not done anything. And in fact, you know, you're actually setting back a privacy movement, a political privacy movement back. And, you know, and EFF is complicit in this because it's one of the main promoters of these tools. As a form of politics. I mean, we live in a world where we've outsourced our politics to apps, you know? it's weird, right? To think that you can do that. Like, but we're at that point and it seems totally normal. Like, Edward Snowden, like, told the Black Lives Matter, you know? It's like, they asked him, like, what should you do to, you know, stay safe on the internet? He's like, use Signal, use Tor, encrypt everything. He's, you know, that's great. That's really gonna change things for Black Lives Matter. You know, it's like to all be living inside an encrypted app is the solution. You know, I don't know. Yeah,
it's a fair answer. It's honest. So I guess tell people where they can get Surveillance Valley.
You can buy Surveillance Valley wherever books are sold, you know, at your local bookstore or anywhere on the internet, really. Yeah. And, I mean, you really should try to support your local bookstore, but not everyone has a local bookstore around, so you got to deal with, you know, whoever we can. but, yeah, of course, you should definitely buy the book. You know, I mean, that goes without saying.
Buy the book.
Buy the book.
And it seems like it's getting very nice, wide distribution because it seems like it is available in a lot of bookstores.
Yeah.
Pretty awesome. So.
Yeah, no, it's cool. I mean,
congratulations.
The New York Times hasn't yet given me a glowing review, but, you know.
Well, thank you for taking the time to come out here and come on Media Roots Radio in person. Yasha, it's great to finally meet you.
Yeah, it's cool, man. Good to meet you, too. Thanks for having me on.
If you're a Media Roots listener and are already donating on Patreon, thank you very much for your contribution. It's greatly appreciated. If you haven't donated to us on Patreon yet, please consider donating to us using our website, patreon.com/mediarootsradio.